Well, throughout the day so far, these are the seven riders who have led the Tour de France, and they're chased now by Carlos Sastre, as they have been over the last climb as well. Sastre almost reached them at a minute 20 seconds. Two riders from Sky in the breakaway, one Antonio Fletcher and Edvald Boysenhagen. They're not cracking on this climb like they did split up on the Col de Maurie Blanc, and there's no way now that Sastre is going to reach him before the bunch, because the gap across the field is 5.5 minutes.
But he's done an incredible ride this afternoon and not asked for any help from anyone. He's been quite content to ride his lonely race in between the group in no man's land for the majority of the afternoon. He missed out by a minute and 20 seconds from joining that leading group of seven. So, Carlos Sastre there just knowing that very shortly he's very likely to get picked up by the front end of the main field, which is still being led here by Tirolongo. Tirolongo, the Italian rider on Team Astana. Just behind him is Daniel Navarro. He had a very nasty crash a couple of days ago. Nicky Sorensen is always very much present. And there you can see the French national champion, red, white and blue, on the shoulders of Thomas Vogler.
Still a long way to go, 5 kilometers to go. This will be for Carlos Sastre now. He's going up 3 minutes, 41 seconds behind those leaders. So he is pulling time back at a reasonable speed. He's about 1.75 minutes he's pulled back since we started the climb. But the peloton have also closed in. They were 8 behind, they're only 5.25 now.
Phil, I should have pulled in that rather stranger coincidence, because when Carlos Sastre won the Tour de France, he made his winning move on stage 17 up to the summit of the Alpe d'Huez, and today is stage 17.
The dreaded stage that everybody seems to either get sick on or retire or get eliminated on, because by tradition stage 17 is usually the hardest day of the Tour de France. And there he is, Carlos Sastre, still finding plenty of kick in those legs there. If he could just reach these boys, he might continue on at the foot of the Col du Tourmalet. He's got the quality to win the day, and that would be a huge result for Carlos, and I have to say well earned because of the way he's ridden the race today.
If he survives after an effort like this, he will go down in the annals of history at the Tour de France, because this would be a legendary performance. He's still looking for 3 minutes and 43 seconds, but the main field, well, they're locked in at 5 minutes and 20 seconds behind the leaders, the seven men at the front of the race, and still there's no real concerted effort. I see what's happening now as they're starting to platform out as well here, with Tirolongo being allowed to do the majority of the pacemaking, but they're still keeping a couple of riders in reserve. And look at Omega Pharma Lotto there. There's Matty Lloyd on the left-hand side. They're all looking after their man, the Belgian, Jürgen van den Broek, who starts the day in fifth place.
Well, if you could see the back of the bunch, you'd now see the youngster, Raphael Valls, who really surprised us in this first day in the Alps, and he finished second on the stage, almost won it. He's just been dropped by the peloton, so the race is a week too long for him at the moment, but he's got plenty of time to improve. This is the peloton now, 5 kilometers to go. Just the fast tempo riding is taking a big pack towards the summit. Even so, there's plenty of riders behind now, but nonetheless, this is becoming a select group of about 45, maybe 50 riders. 172 started the stage today. A very big field for this stage of the Tour de France, I must say, and with 8 teams still taking everybody to Paris, that's a big bunch of teams still complete.
It certainly is. Just going to mention, Phil, I just noticed Grisha Neerman at the back end of the main field. I don't think I've mentioned his name throughout the whole of this Tour de France. He rides for Team Rabobank.
So, as Astana still control the peloton, Andy Schleck is waiting for the climb of the Tourmalet. That is when he must attack. Looking down to the seven leaders, they're just about 2 kilometers still to climb up the Soulor. And they've climbed it much, much better than they've climbed the Murray Blanc, but the clock is saying they've lost on this climb nearly 3 minutes of their advantage.
Well, it's good to see Boysenhagen getting himself into a rhythm there just on the front of this group. He's learned an awful lot, I think, about himself in this last 2.5 weeks of racing, and he will go away from the Tour de France a much stronger rider. Everybody and all the doctors always say that physiologically, if you can finish a 3-week bike race, it actually changes you completely, because it gives you a latent strength that you've always got. Even when you start to get tired, there's that strength that you get from the last week of a 3-week Grand Tour.
Well, there's a few guys going to need that strength before the end of this day as they go up the giant called the Tourmalet. There we are, onto an average of 6.5% now. That's at 3 kilometers to go for Sastre.
Yep, and he will probably be around about a kilometre on the road behind the leading group of seven riders, and maybe three quarters of a kilometre ahead of the main field, who now, Phil, are really starting to see that gap come down. It's tumbling.
One or two of the cars going by there might not be a good sign here. 5.07, and here they come, the pacemaker from Astana. Stopped any attack. Chris Horner on the right, his little escapade in the breakaway with Lance Armstrong as we came to our rest day. It was a great result for him there, because he's now sitting in 14th place in the Tour de France.
Yeah, I was a bit shocked when I was looking back through his records the other day, Phil, to realise that he too is 38 years of age, a real serious ambassador. There's Sammy Sanchez as well. Cast your mind back, it seems like hours ago that he was on the ground and we thought maybe he was going to pull out of the Tour de France because he had that very nasty crash onto his thorax. But now he's got himself back in and he's recovered and he's in contact. But for him, it's going to be a major battle to hold on to third place on the slopes of the Tour.
Well, it was hours ago, nearly three, in fact. There's David Zabriskie, number 59, sat near the back of the bunch, but he's found himself in this last week of the Tour, coming out very, very strongly indeed. But it's the expected men sitting at the front here, everybody poised and waiting for their leaders to say, this is it, showdown. And the leaders are today Contador, Schleck, Sanchez, Menchoff and Jürgen van den Broek. They're the five men, really, who will try to cover the moves. Levi Leipheimer, who sits in the best-placed American in seventh, he wants to move. He doesn't know if he can.
Well, he wants to see if he can do something special on this stage, and he started the day in seventh place overall. I think his only real chance is maybe moving ahead of Robert Gesink, the Dutchman, who's just in front of him by about 20 seconds. But Gesink is riding extremely well, and I've just noticed Gesink moving up to the top end of the main field. Well, I think it might be 1K to go to the top there, Phil, but it's hard to see through the mist.
It should be 1 kilometre to go for the breakaway here at this point, as they're being led up now by the Cofidis rider, Rémi Poriol. We're really up amongst the crowd now. It kicks a little bit violently, and then we continue at slowing. And I don't blame Christian Coron there getting his racing cape out early, because it's getting wet now. This low cloud, it actually feels as though you are in quite heavy rain now. This is Luis Leon Sanchez.
He's getting his raincoat ready for the descent, and he realises how important it is to stay warm. The chill factor really can get you very cold indeed on the descent of these climbs.
Oh, what's going on here?
I've never seen that before. Well, a bunch of sheep just came across the front end of the main field. You had said that they do move up when the cloud starts to come down, but there they've got a few shepherds on our side.
Well, this is a problem and a shame, but the sheep have come up the bank there. They need to go back down the road here. The rider's doing well.
I don't think I've seen this since the days of the milk race, when it used to go deep into the heart of Wales.
That's absolutely right, but they do run wild here. The farmers who own them don't even come to tent for them. They wander over the Pyrenees. They drive them down to the lower slopes when the bad weather sets in for the winter. Of course, they don't leave them up here in the snow.
Well, Contador almost got himself a new woolen yellow jersey there.
There's a retake on that one.
This is right in front of the main field now. If you watch, you can see the Astana riders coming. They've just slowed down. There's Contador just going through as well. And I think that must have had... Pity we didn't have Contador's heart rate monitor on then.
Well, yesterday on the rest day, there must have been 1,000 of them come down the mountain. And I saw the police stop the traffic. And they did a mock wave at the sheep to say, you've got the right of way, keep coming. And that was a moment of comedy at La Mangie on the mountain. But today could have been very serious.
I tell you what, Phil, I'm just looking there. I see Fabian Cancellara is still in here for Team Saxo Bank. Stuart O'Grady is in there. This is what the weather looks like at the top of the Col du Tourmalet for this man. And this is the man who lies in eighth place on the road, Carlos Sastre. He really is trying to find his way through this event.
A lot of it might be fog on the screen, on the lens here, because the weather temperature changes very rapidly and it may just have fogged up a little bit. So it's the visibility, I think, might be better than it appears just now. This is the top for the boys as they race up towards the summit of the Col du Tourmalet. Again, no interest in the King of the Mountains points here, so it looks to me as though it's going to be Marcus Burkhardt, who was off the back on the Col de la Marie Blanc, who's going to maybe go through the banner in first place.
Yep, he's looking around the corner all of the time, and it's a good operation, really, for B-Box Bouygues Telecom, because their man, Anthony Chateau, must be starting to smile a fraction, Phil, because he is leading one of those competitions that will be decided at the end of today's stage, because after the Col du Tourmalet, there is not one more categorised hill in the Tour de France this year.
Well, there now remains for the winner of the last climb of the day, just 40 points. And I think now that's made him more or less safe, except from Christophe Moreau, the only man who could take it off him. 1 kilometre to go now for Carlos Sastre. He seems to be closing in on those boys, but not quick enough. Officially 3 minutes and 8 seconds back of the breakaway. But the bunch now are coming up. They're inside 5 minutes behind the leaders.
Yeah, but Carlos Sastre has retained his position in front of the main field because he's still leading that main field, Phil, by a good 2 minutes over the top of the climb, as it's still Marcus Burkhardt about to lead them over the top.
Burkhardt over the top then from Christian Corran.
Well, as long as this man survives to take eighth place, the only way now that the man in second position in the King of the Mountains can win, Christophe Moreau, is by taking sixth place on the stage. And despite the fact that we're going to have a big battle, I can't really see Moreau doing that.
No, in principle not. The Spanish spectators there suddenly realised they were looking at the great Carlos Sastre there. Suddenly warm themselves up. The order over the summit: Burkhardt, Curran, Perez, Poriol, Fletcher, Kolobnev and Hagen in that front seven-man group.
Still big pressure being done at the front end of the group there. There's Grisha Neerman, I was talking to you about that just a few moments ago, 197. Luis Leon Sanchez over onto the right-hand side there, number 161. He's just happy, I think, to be surviving this last week of the tour. I expected big things of him. This is a very dangerous descent now, Phil, off the Soulor in the mist here. These riders, they'll be taking huge risks, and a lot of the time they won't be able to see what the corner is actually starting to look like.
Well, what it looks like, these boys have been a bit disrupted by the chasing of the Mouton, but they seem to be okay again, reorganized, a kilometer to go to the summit for them. The time check they're saying is coming down all the time, 4:41, as they continue to climb up. But they've got the extra problem now of the fog, which is much more dangerous for the riders in the peloton because they don't all see where they're going. Just wanting a little bit of help here from the back. This is Muraev of the Radio Shack team, wants a drink or something.
He's probably taking on board jackets. Maybe for the rest of the guys. And just in front of him, Sylvain Chavanel. Chavanel's had a phenomenal tour. In fact, a team Cofidis were trying to sign him up during the illegal transfer season during the Tour de France. But in fact, we're just hearing that he's renewed his contract, Phil, with Team Quickstep.
Yeah, there's the confirmation of the standings we talked about. Burkhardt over the top from Corran and Perez. All seven riders are locked in, same time over the top. And Anthony Chartou keeps on to that polka dot jersey. One climb left in this year's Tour de France. And if it all goes well now, he's going to be crowned the winner tonight.
Which I made a quick miscalculation there. In fact, Christophe Moreau has to finish in sixth or seventh place minimum to try and get the lead, and that's going to be a tall order. I did notice he was riding the front end of the pack, though.
I'd be very surprised if Christophe can climb the Col du Tourmalet with the might of the leaders of the Tour de France. Sastre goes over. 2:51 for Carlos Sastre. And he was 1:20 behind over the Marie Blanc. So he has pulled back a big chunk of his lost time in between, because he went out to 4 minutes behind. That goes over 2:51.
That's an incredible escapade. And this race, I think, would have been completely different, Phil, if on the slopes of the Col de Marie Blanc he had made the junction at the front end. Everybody now getting wrapped up for the descent. And there you can see Daniel Navarro on the front end of the main field for Team Astana. But check that out, Stewie O'Grady's up there as well.
Yes, that's why it's been good tempo riding up the climb, but he hasn't got rid of the non-climbers at all this. There was no real pressure by the stars of the Tour de France today. They're leaving it to a showdown on the 18.6-kilometre mountain of the Col du Tourmalet.
Check that out. Alexander Vinokourov took on board two bags there. He's taken one for himself, and I'll bet my bottom dollar that he's going to pass the other bag across to Alberto Contador.
So, as they now sort out their drinks and prepare for the rather hazardous descent here of the Col du Soulor, the breakaway here, we'll have to see whether they can catch the leaders or will they leave it to the last 18.6 kilometres of the day. Stuart O'Grady making the tempo riding up here. The top is just about there now, and they go over the top. 4, 22 behind officially for the chase. It's all possible now to bring this race all together as they start the climb of the Col du Tourmalet, and then it really will be every man for himself. Delicate descending down here now on slick roads. As we're coming out of the cloud, we continue to descend away from the Col du Soulour. Next stop will be the valley floor, and then we climb up the giant Col du Telegraph to 2,115 metres, and the race stops right on the top. This is Carlos Sastre, still ahead on his own, still catching up those leaders, but he's 2.49 behind.
Well, if you had any questions about whether or not the chalk bot would survive the torrential downpour here this afternoon, there's proof that he has. All of those little yellow signs that are signs and messages that people have logged onto livestrong.org to post messages to their family who may have been struck by cancer have survived the torrential downpour here this afternoon as we make our way back up to the leading group of seven.
Breakaway here continues to remain the same names that have been out front now since the second kilometre of the race. And surprisingly, they're all still pretty strong here. The bunch went over behind them at 4.22. They've descended better. They're now out to 4.39. I don't suppose it'll matter.
Well, it shouldn't matter too much, and I don't think that, Phil, is going to be enough to survive on the slopes of the Col du Tourmalet, the climb of 18 kilometres up to the high spot of the Tour at 2,115 metres. But I do get a little bit of respite from the fog, which made that descent just a little bit more precarious. They actually haven't reached the descent yet, Phil, proper, because this is a plateau halfway down, and that's when they will start to go down even further into the outskirts of Luz Saint-Sauveur.
Van first to put his jersey on as they went up the mountain, Christian Corran. He also went over the top in second place. The boys in the power output looking at the computer pushed out in the leaders, 367 watts. Carlos Sastre was burning 390 while the peloton, and they closed the gap on the climb. They were out of 403.
Yep, it's starting to get a little bit grippy in the main field behind because of the chase, and it wouldn't have been that hard, the chase, if this man hadn't been riding off the front end of the main field since the Col du Marais Blanc. This man has got a big reputation. They know him. He's won stages in the Tour de France before. He's won the Tour de France as well, and that's why they couldn't allow him to ride too far off the front end of the main field, because this has been a phenomenal performance by Carlos Sastre. I don't think it's going to pay at the end of the day, but if you don't take the risk, you don't get the win.
This is Stuart O'Grady on the front. They're just making this a routine descent here. They're taking their team leaders to the bottom of the Col du Tourmalet. Then they will release them, and it'll be every man for himself. He who gets to the top will probably be the next leader of the Tour de France. Who knows? It's going to be a great final climb, 18.6 kilometres long.
Yep, there's still no sign of any weakness in this group at all, Phil. Everybody's prepared to come to the front end of the group and do the pacemaking. I see Juan Antonio Fletcher's got his racing cape on there, keep himself nice and warm. Remy Poriol, he's calmed down a bit now, his heart rate down to 136. That's around about 60% of his maximum, but the wattage is still pretty impressive at just inside of 400 watts for 28 miles an hour.
Sastre, what a lonely day out this man has had today. Just going through, yo-yoing behind the leaders. He's now dropping out to 3 minutes and 5 seconds. So he's only a minute and 50-odd behind the leaders. So there's still a chance there, but it's 4.54 only now to the peloton of Contador. So he's 3.06 behind the leaders, only a minute and 50-odd ahead of the peloton.
Well, he's still surviving, and I really am amazed that he decided to do this. It's a phenomenal performance. It won't pay, I don't think, at the end of the day, but as I say, he's just hoping to survive if he can now to the start of the Col du Tourmalet. But he will, I think, get pulled in on the Col du Tourmalet, because we're getting now down to the kind of time gaps which give the advantage to the battle of Contador and Andy Schleck.
Well, we're now very much in the department of the High Pyrenees, the Haute Pyrenees. Came there just before we started the climb of the Col du Soulour. This is our last rendezvous with the Pyrenees today. There's a sprint in Adas for the green jersey competition. These boys will still be clear for that, and I doubt very much that anybody's going to worry about the sprint either. But then we move over towards the base town of the Col du Tourmalet, and that's when it all happens.
Somebody's back in the team cars there, having a bit of a break. There you can see Juan Antonio Fletcher. He's quite prepared, waiting for the moment to come forward. This young man here is a young man that is riding the Tour de France for his first attempt, and that's Christian Koren. He's a Slovenian rider on Team Liquigas. Liquigas have not really, Phil, had the tour that I was expecting of them. In fact, yesterday, Ivan Basso probably did something that he's never, ever done in his career before, and that was finish the mountain stage in the autobus at 38 minutes behind the rest.
But he says he's ill, he's suffering with bronchitis, I think it is, and it's apparent because he lost 9 minutes on the first climb of the day. So he obviously gave up very early on yesterday. Anyway, we're racing through now towards Adast, and then we will race into the village of Luz-Saint-Sauveur. Beautiful town tucked away in the Pyrenees. In the past, we've raced through there from the Col du Tourmalet and climbed up the big climb of Luz-Ardiden. But today, it's the Col du Tourmalet non-stop to the top.
It's a long climb, it's 18 kilometres, but as far as I'm concerned, Phil, it's more like 30 kilometres because they actually start climbing once they go through the town of Adast. I mean, it's only an ascent of around about 300 or 400 metres, but it's still going to toughen up the body for the final 18 kilometres uphill. So, just looking here, this should be Carlos Sastre. And he now is he's fading now on that seven-man leading group because he's now trailing them by 3 minutes and 25 seconds as he now also goes through the small town of Marsou. Just a little village, not too far from the start of the final few kilometres downhill into the valley below.
The lonely road of the village is here as Sastre picks his way through. You can see where he's going. Breakaway here, still driving on. They're determined to get to the foot of the Col du Tourmalet together. This is right on the back is Poriol, the Frenchman in the breakaway. Remy Poriol, remember, France had 6 stage wins in this year's Tour de France. They're having their best tour for many, many years. But they're not going to win this one, the Tourmalet down the road. The long, steady freewheel away from the Col du Soulor. We're racing to our final rendezvous in the mountains of the Pyrenees, which is the Col du Tourmalet. Andy Schleck said in his press conference yesterday, I need probably 2, maybe 1, but he wants to start last in the time trial, which means he must be in yellow tonight to do that. That will not be easy. He's got no choice now. He has to attack as soon as the slopes start on the Col du Tourmalet. It makes great and gripping television, that's for sure. And this is Carlos Sastre here, who has tried to cross the gap for the last 3.5 hours, and he's still trying to bridge a loosening 3 minutes and 58 seconds. These are the leaders here now. They're dropping into the town of Adast, and then they're on the way through and out. Very soon we'll see the sign, Luz-Saint-Sauveur, and that's at the base of the Col du Tourmalet.
Huge crowd turned out here, and many of these people have camped out for days to see the Tour de France come through. It's an incredible crowd here who are looking to witness, I think, what they hope, Phil, is going to be a legendary showdown in the Tour de France on the slopes of the Tourmalet. The last 18 kilometres of today's stage are uphill. We're through the points sprint here, and nobody's really too concerned. I think they're all concerned, though, about the final climb of the day.
Well, lucky or what, because they seem to be turning the tap off everywhere these riders go. It's been pouring with rain, and when the Tour arrives, look at the roads, they're drying out. And even on the Tourmalet now, they've turned the tap off here as well, and the sun is peeping through. Maybe this will be a fitting salute to the Tour de France, celebrating 100 years in these mountains, as 7 riders try to get onto that climb ahead of the rest. They know that behind, the race will explode. They need a more, I think, than 4 minutes, but you never know.
Well, this is the small town of Argelès-Gazost. In fact, the sprint point, I think, Phil, is around about 3 or 4 kilometres still to go down the road. And yep, there's still a little bit more descent before they actually get to it.
No, they've got a little way to go yet. And probably 14 kilometres to the town before they start the climb up to the finishing line. The last 18.5 kilometres don't ease at all. They'll be held up on the bikes when they get to the top, because that's it. They finish right on the brow, under the shadow of the great steel of the quite famous organiser of the Tour de France, Henri de Grange.
And there's a special award for the first rider to get to the top as well, and that has always been the high spot of the Tour, where they've usually put the souvenir Henri de Grange. In the Alps, it's very often on the slopes of the Col du Galibier, but here this year, it's on the summit of the Col du Tourmalet.
That's right. When we came up the other way the other day, up the Tourmalet, they gave it the prize of the recent director, who's now passed on, Jacques Godet. So it was a special Jacques Godet prize. And now this way, it is the prize, the man that founded the Tour de France. He was a good cyclist himself, by the way, and he worked for a sporting newspaper called L'Auto. We're watching the descent here now of the rider who is absolutely in no man's land, but he's no stranger to that right now. Sasha's been here all day. He's 4-7, which puts him now 1 minute to 23 seconds only in front of the main field containing Schleck and Contador.
Well, you've got to really take your hat off to the performance of Carlos Sastre, because he's had the whole of Team Astana, the whole of Omega Pharma Lotto and Saxo Bank chasing him, and they haven't been able to pull him back. And that really is a great performance. We're back a little further up the road here to the seven-man leading group, while there are different riders coming to the front end of the main field now, getting ready for the big showdown, which we've all been expecting, we've all been talking about, which is about to happen on the slopes of the Col du Tourmalet. There's Fulsang coming to the front now for Team Saxo Bank. Interesting to note that Fabian Cancellara is in the group, and I have a feeling that starting to see Team Saxo Bank get the preparation laid, Phil, for their big move when we come to the Tourmalet, because I'm sure Andy Schleck spoke to the guys in the team meeting this morning and said, guys, let's all get over these climbs together. Let's all make sure that we can do something special, because I want to do everything I can to try and get back that yellow jersey.
5:31, it's nudging back out again. Can you believe this? Those seven men are building up once more. 34 kilometres, just over 20 miles to go to the top and the finish of this stage of the Tour de France. They're going to see the Tourmalet, I think, ahead of Sastre and ahead of the peloton. But just by how much? Another marvellous crowd here now. This is Pierrefitte here now for Sastre. No, we're back to the town of Adast at the moment. Angers-Gazost.
Yeah,
it's a bit earlier for these boys, yeah.
It's about Sastre, yeah. 5 kilometres for Sastre before he gets to the sprint town over Adast, and that's just a little bit further up the road. But this is a very important town for the French, because if you've heard of the French aperitif called pastis, its origin actually comes from this town. It's made from an aniseed base, and the French drink it in their cocktail period, and they mix it with water, and it's a funny old drink. It's a bit like Pernod, actually.
Yeah, great rivals, because the Pernod company will never tell you how they make that from the herbs and wildflowers spread across the Alps. Secret recipe, so they did their own. And we're down in the Pyrenees here. 5:34 the gap, 33. It's being knocked down all the time, but not fast enough, I think. But look at this, the roads are drying nicely now as we leave this town. And that's what the riders want to see. We want a nice, clean flight. A fight up the mountain of the Tourmalet, that's for sure. We've never climbed the western side before to finish on the summit. It's a first.
Well, you see now the teams who are very keen now, Phil, to get their riders to the front end of the main field, because now it's the turn of Rabobank. And they're concerned about making sure that Denis Menchov rides and approaches the Tourmalet in an ideal position. Now, if you cast your mind back to the time trial in the Critérium de Dauphiné in the month of June, in fact, Denis Menchov beat Alberto Contador in the time trial on that occasion, and he could well be nurturing a thought of creating the surprise in the individual time trial, but to do that, he has to stay in contact today.
Big effort required. How injured is Sanchez after crushing his sternum and the fall today? There we are. We're just approaching the sprint here. Are they going to sprint? Looks like they are. They're going to have a little go for the prize at the line.
Well, that's Bosenhagen getting himself the points there. 6 points in his back pocket and around about €800. Kolobnev getting across the line there in second place, as these guys now start to start the long valley road, which will take them up to Luz Saint-Sauveur. Remy Perriol got third place there. That's the rider in the red jersey there on the far side from Team Cofidis. So, with the main field starting to pick up momentum now as they get the slowly but surely towards the foot of the big final climb of the day, the climb of the Col du Tourmalet, there's different teams now starting to take a serious interest in the front end of the main field. But we still have the seven riders off the front end of the main field chased by Carlos Sastre.
These
Well, we're now just looking at this seven-man leading group who possess a five-and-a-half-minute advantage over the front end of the main field. Now, the rider who's done the majority of the pacemaking over the last 10 minutes is Juan Antonio Fletcher. The other riders have been fairly even in their contribution to the pacemaking in this group, as Bosenhagen just nips off the front a fraction.
28.5 kilometres to go now. 5.22 the gap.
They're now looking at 10 kilometres to go to the start of the climb, but I will have to say, Phil, that around about 5 of those 10 kilometres are slightly uphill, because we go along the long valley road which takes the riders into that very famous spa town of Luz-Saint-Sauveur.
Well, the leaders are looking for Soulom, would be the next village, as they now make their way through.
That's Nicolas Sarkozy, the French president, is the honoured guest today, and he certainly has got a very nice ringside view.
He loves cycling, he loves the Tour de France, and he tries to put in at least one appearance on one of the stages. He's chosen today, the last day in the Alps, as they now say goodbye to their 100th year celebrations to the Tour de France. And I think he's in for the best seat in the house as we get into the last 18 kilometres of the race.
Well, what a battle he's looking to witness here this afternoon. Matty Breschel coming to the front, setting the pacemaking. Lots of work being done at the back now, Phil, as everybody gets themselves ready for this final ascent of the final climb of this year's Tour de France.
Anxious moments for the domestiques here. Last drinks before they start climbing up to the finishing line. You can see the clouds shrouded over the top of the Col du Tourmalet, but they'll come through that crowd. I'm looking out the commentary box. He's actually just swirled it to our level just about, but the sun is still above it. So we are not going to have a cloudy climb just yet, as the peloton get ready now for the assault. And it's surprisingly Rabobank who've taken over here for Menchoft and Gesink.
Well, they know they've got a big chance today, and they've got the big tactical advantage of having two riders in the top 10 places overall, and maybe they're going to try and make that a tactical manoeuvre, the old 1-2 if possible for Gesink and Denny Menchoff. Menchoff started the day in fourth place overall, and he's dreaming of a podium position, and why not even higher than that? Maybe he dreams about getting himself the overall lead as well.
Who knows? It's all about to be found out. This is Michael Rogers here with his hand up, and he's dropping back pretty quickly there. Not too sure whether he might have a problem with his bike rather than wanting a drink.
Well, Koos Murenhout at the back there, he's trying to make his way through the main field with drinks. That's 196. He announced that at the end of this year he will be retiring from the sport, and he's getting up there to 37 years of age. He's twice been the champion of Holland, and he wants to make his way right up to the front end of the main field here to dish out the drinks to his teammates. That's Lars Boom in second position, and in first position that's Grisha Neerman. That's the first time we've really seen him. You know, all of these teams now taking a serious note of how important this final 18 kilometres of today's stage is going to be.
It's the domestiques earning the pay, that's what it is.
So Carlos Sastre can't be too far away now from being caught by the main field, because I've got him pegged at 4 minutes and 46 seconds behind the seven-man leading group, and 5 minutes and 12 seconds back to the main field. Sastre looking over his shoulder. He knows as a seasoned professional now that his escapade through the Pyrenees is almost over for the day. He looks back and he'll try and recover a little bit if he can over the next few kilometres and see if he can still have something left in those legs of his for the assault of the Col du Tourmalet. And he may well, because I think everybody else in that main field behind, because of the pressure and the tempo that's been set on this race since the very start, they'll all be suffering quite a bit. Yep, they should pretty much have Carlos Sastre in their sights now on the long straight part of the course. He's probably only 500 metres ahead.
The sights of Rabobank here at the front. They're going to see Carlos Sastre any second now. He's about 45 seconds in front. As they now get ready, inch by inch, they're heading towards the town. They've been through Soulon. And now the next stop will be Esquies. Then it'll be Luz-Saint-Sauveur, and then they're on the slopes of the Tourmalet.
Then it's all up to the top at 2,115 metres in altitude. Maxime Montfort just sitting at the back there. We've gone through the sprint point. Now, not too far away from these guys is the real start of the climb proper. 18.9 kilometres to go to the summit. They will see when they go past that point.
Hopefully our pictures will behave. They've been pretty good all day today. The atmospherics are playing a part. 25 kilometres to go now for the front seven riders. My goodness me, what a breakaway for those boys today. They've been in the lead for 148 kilometres so far. and looking to try and lead this race for all bar the first couple of kilometres of the day. And Sastre, he's been out there by himself all day as well, and he's still 5 minutes behind the rider. He's 4:51 behind now, but the peloton, well, they're on him.
They're breathing down his neck. I think he's sat up now. He knows that he's not going to survive to the foot of the Tourmalet. What he's got to try and do now, though, Phil, is get himself a bit of breath back into that body of his before he starts the final climb of the day. But he may well not lose too much time on a stage like this, because if you look at this main field, they've been under pressure right from the get-go this morning.
Concentration. Sastre shortly to be put back in his place. That was his team car that just went past the peloton, or the other way around.
Well, there, number 191 is Denny Menchoff. Now, he is the leader of Team Rabobank, getting a last little bit of food into him, Carlos Sastre. A great, brave move here this afternoon, and I do really think that if he got across to that leading group of seven on the slopes of the Col de Marie Blanc, the first category climb of the day, this race would have been a whole lot harder, because they would have put serious pressure on him and serious pressure on all of the teams to chase him down. He was looking to climb himself up into the top 10 in the overall standings. Well, that doesn't look as it's going to work this afternoon, but at least he went down fighting. So, looking here at Carlos Sastre, back in the main field now after a long escapade over the top of some very big climbs this afternoon. Lars Boom is the rider on the front, so he's just thinking about his own teammates. He's thinking about Denny Menchoff, he's thinking about Robert Gesink, while we look at the riders at the back end of the main field, and rider Heijerdahl, number 54, riding quite a long way back. Well, this is Carlos Sastre. He was the man who had that incredible escapade off the front end of the main field for almost the whole of the day. He never quite made it up to the leading group of seven, and that leading group of seven is still in existence with 4 minutes and 13 seconds over the front end of the main field. Quick reminder, Fletcher and Bosenhagen from Sky, Christoph Koren from Liquigas, Kolobnev, Burkhardt, Poriol and Perez.
So the scene is set, Paul. It's all eyes down. There's no turning around now. The quickest way to get over to Saint-Maurice-de-Compans is to go over the Col du Tourmalet today. These boys are now 100% committed.
They are, and look at the speed they go along this valley road. And this, I'm just saying, Phil, is not the categorised part of the climb, but it is slightly uphill until they get into the outskirts of Luce Saint-Sever, and then the gradient changes from 4% to 5% to 9%, and it stays between 8 and 9% then for 18.9 kilometres.
It's dead ahead, shrouded in fog from just a few hundred feet up. But I can tell you on the top, they must come through the cloud, because we're back in sunshine here. Just on 7,000 feet to the top of this mountain. Goodness gracious me. The last climb of the Tour, the most revered mountain in the history of the Tour de France. It was there 100 years ago. The road service was slightly burst, I think, in those days.
Well, in those days, it was actually a dirt track that the riders came over once they crested this for the first time in 1910, and the first man to go over the top of the climb was Octave Lapize way back in 1910. They have improved the road a fraction, but they haven't changed the gradient very much. Bosenhagen, he is very keen. He will have enjoyed today's stage of the Tour de France, and these guys have done a phenomenal job, because they've hardly lost any of their advantage over the last 20 kilometres or so. And that, I think, is going to put a little bit of fear and trepidation into the main field, who know they need to pull back these four men. And I'm sure we're going to see this big battle, Phil. It's the battle that we've been waiting for many, many days. Contador versus Schleck.
4 minutes and 4 seconds at 20 kilometres to go for the seven leaders now. And they've got just over a kilometre before they come into the town of Luce Saint-Sauveur, and then straight onto the climb. And it's going to be a massive explosion in the peloton as soon as they hit the slopes of this climb, because the leaders must attack, and in particular, Schleck must attack.
No, he certainly has to attack. I'm not sure he's going to attack as soon as the climb starts. He will probably look to make a move at around about 8 or 9 kilometres to go. But, you know, Alberto Contador is no fool. He's won the last four Grand Tours he's participated in. He knows he has one man to watch, and he knows that one man has a white jersey on his back as the best young rider, second overall. And he knows that Alberto Contador knows he has to watch Schleck all the way up the slopes of this climb.
Closing in on the town right now, but he's got to make 90 seconds. He may not make 90 seconds in the last 6 kilometres of the day, and that man knows that. Contador. They've made friends after the Contador apologised for attacking when he stopped to have his chain put back on. I don't see why he should, but he did. And Contador now pushes on. And he's going to have to watch Andy Schleck. Schleck wants that yellow jersey back. He doesn't just want to win the white jersey. There he is. He's done it for the previous 2 years. This will be the last time he'll win this competition. Age will have caught up.
Well, I think he'll be looking at around about 8 or 9 kilometres to go to the summit. He's got to go a long way out, Phil, if he wants to get the big time caps. Maybe all he wants to do is get a smaller time gap and get himself just ahead of Alberto Contador for the individual time trial and gamble on riding the best individual time trial of his life. That, I think, though, is a bit of a gamble because, you know, Alberto Contador is the best time trialist in the race.
Maybe we'll find that out on Saturday. We'll see who starts out of the box last, though, because that's crucial. That's why Schleck wants the yellow jersey, if it's only by a handful of seconds. He would love to be last to start the time trial. Then he has a shot. He's already said if Contador is chasing him, he won't be able to beat him in the time trial. So it's all down to Andy Schleck now to reclaim yellow by anything he can make on Contador in the next 18.7 kilometres. This is the town of Lucin-Savour. The last climb of the Tour is about to begin. You'll see the sign the same time as we do. It'll say Col du Tourmalet, 18.6 kilometres.
And all of a sudden, you can actually see the change in the gradient. We've been riding along at 3 and 4% gradient along the valley road, and now all of a sudden, it's starting to crank up. It's getting to 5%, 6%, 8.5%. And it will start to bite into these riders' legs. They've had such an incredibly long escapade, and they're still holding on to only just inside a 4 minutes advantage.
We're looking up the long road here. I haven't actually seen the sign of 18.6, but there's such a huge crowd here in Lucin-Sauvert, the foot of the Tourmalet, the side we very rarely come up, and this is the western side of the mountain, which stands just on 7,000 feet above sea level. A magnificent crowd. Many of these people would have been up the mountain, but the rain was so torrential, they all opted to stay in town today.
Well, they're all waiting to see what sort of a legendary stage we're about to witness here. Look at that. The crowd is amazing, Phil. I'm not sure what it's going to be like a bit further up because the road has been closed for a couple of days. The police actually closed down both sides of the Col du Tourmalet 3 days ago. The people who've got the best vantage points are the people who came in 4 and 5 days ago in their camping cars and their tents to witness this final big mountain stage of the Tour.
The peloton chases about 2 kilometres behind as the leaders go on to the climb of the Col du Tourmalet. There it is, 18.6 kilometres, it says, and it's all uphill now, and there's no respite till you get to the finishing line high above the world in the Pyrenees.
That's Juan Antonio Fletcher, number 34, sitting at the back. Sky, I think, on this breakaway move today, Phil, looking for a bit of redemption from what has been, for them, a slightly disappointing Tour de France. It is the first time they've participated. They're going to have to go away from here and learn from their mistakes. But I think they will learn that they've got a great talent in the man who wears number 36 there, Edward Bosenhagen. He really is an incredible bike rider. He is one of the names of the future of this sport.
Well, they'll be on the road to redemption if Edward Bosenhagen won the day, and he may do yet. He's got on to there. He's going to get on about 3:30 with Carlos Sastre. He played his cards. They didn't work. He's been dropped by the peloton as the climb begins.
Well, he made the big risk. He had an incredible escapade, and obviously he was in 15th place at the start of the day, Phil, but for him, it was a question of 15th, top 10, top 5, or nothing, and I think he's now opted for nothing.
Well, the pacemakers of the top two riders in the Tour de France, Schleck of Saxo Bank, Contador of Astana. Those are the two men now. They'll watch their team men keep the pace high. It's up to Schleck now. He's got to attack.
Matty Breschel, Phil, is turning himself inside out here. This is a rider who has raced for a long time this season. He was aggressive in the one-day classics in April, and now he knows that the next few kilometres he's got to bury himself for his team leader. Andy Schleck is requiring his teammates to do something extremely special today, and we still know that even Stuart O'Grady and Fabian Cancellara in this group, so important it is, I think, to have a strong squad on the early slopes of the Col du Tourmalet.
Well, celebrating this 100 years of the introduction of the Pyrenees into the Tour de France, over these past 4 days of racing, although we've been in the mountains for 5 days with the rest day, I think we toured every famous climb that the race has ever had. And this is the big one. We've been over it the other way already. Now we're climbing to its summit to finish the stage of the tour. There are no more counting hills in the King of the Mountains, even on the road to Paris. This is also the battle for the King of the Mountains today.
Just check out the watches, though, Phil. This gives you an idea of how hard this climb is starting to get. Christian Koren's heart rate is up to 156 beats a minute, but his wattage that he's putting out is 500, and it's going to be at 500 for the next 18 kilometres, because that's what's required to get up the slopes of this mountain.
But note, he's climbing the lower slopes at 14 miles an hour. And it's Bosun Hagen who's gone first. He looked good, but he's cracked first on the Tourmalet.
Well, he's got a lot to learn, this young man, and I'm sure he will learn. He's had 2 third-place finishes in the Tour de France this year, but he will have enjoyed what has been a magical stage. He's been at the front of the Tour de France for a good 4 hours here this afternoon.
Well, they'll pick him up pretty quickly, I think. They're running at around 3 minutes and 7 seconds behind what are now 6 leaders on the stage here. There's the sign for the Col d'Aubisque. If you go the other way, that's not what they want to see right now. As they continue, 41 there, who's supposedly suffering from bronchitis and lost 35 minutes into Po, as the peloton themselves start the climb now at Ivan Basso.
Ivan Basso not enjoying this last week of the tour. The riders, Phil, climbing the Col du Tourmalet for the 75th time in the history of the Tour de France. Now, look at this. You think this is a bunch sprint. It's a battle for the start of the Col du Tourmalet, and Cancellara is there with Stuart O'Grady.
But for how long can they possibly keep up these speeds? These are the domestiques. Their job is to charge as long as they can and then drop out of it. Kolobnev is pushing on here. This little group is desperate, and they believe that they can hold them off to the top. It's some belief that at 3 minutes and 1 second, believe me.
Well, Kolobnev is hoping to survive. He had a great start to the season. Stewie O'Grady, look at that face. He really is looking...
Fletcher's gone.
Yeah, they're all cracking one by one now, and that's all to do with the pressure coming from Alexander Kolobnev, who was second in Liège-Bastogne-Liège, but he got himself a victory in the Russian National Championships.
So we're now down to 5 riders in that front group. The 2 Sky Boys first to go there, and now we've lost Rémy Poriol. He's gone. As 2 riders push on here, they're trying to go clear.
Marcus Burkhardt has managed to stay with Alexander Kolobnev. In fact, he's not stayed with him. He's gone better than him, because he's now gone to the front. Remember the Tour of Switzerland. This man had a very difficult start to the season. Then all of a sudden, just 2 weeks before the start of the Tour, bang, he goes in the Tour of Switzerland and gets himself 2 stage victories.
He's got to make his effort from the bottom, because they'll chew him down otherwise. He's 2:59, the gap now. And they've got to start early. They'll pick up the other riders. Then there'll be a little bit of confusion as to how many they've caught, perhaps. But this is going to become a personalised in-battle eventually between the yellow jersey and the white jersey of Schleck. They'll ride pretty close to each other, and Contador will always be looking. And at the moment, they're climbing side by side on the mountain. Basso has gone. No point now, because he lost this race a few days ago.
He finished at 38 minutes behind 2 days ago, the day before the rest day. He is struggling to stay in the Tour de France here this afternoon, and that's not a sight that he's used to, because let's not forget, just 2 months ago, he was the winner of the Giro d'Italia.
The Tour de France is a much, much more difficult race than the Giro d'Italia because of the height of the competition, the pressure put on the riders for the publicity they send around the world, and it cracks them one after another. Cancellara is still at the front of the group here. That man is an incredible man. He knows he won't be finishing with any of these guys in the next 5 kilometres. There's Contador, looking very good, being trailed by Chris Horner.
Horner looking very good there. Horner up in the top 15 in the overall standings. But that's the man we're all waiting to see if he's got the legs this afternoon. Look at that face on Andy Schleck. He's asked the team to really pull themselves inside out this afternoon. And it's amazing to see on this big mountain stage. We've still got Stuart O'Grady, still got Fabian Cancellara, still got Matty Breschel, Fools Gang. They're all up here for Saxo Bank today. They're trying to do something special.
15 kilometres to go for the 2 leaders now. The Russian rider Kolobnev, the Danish rider Burkhardt, the face of Cancellara here. This is his last visit to the front of the peloton today. Could even be the winner of the time trial on Saturday. But today, it's up to the limit and then peel off and just get home as best you can.
They're toughening it up to try and lay down the foundations for an attack for their man, Andy Schleck. In second position, just behind Chris Anker Sorensen. A little bit further back, it's again, Fulsgang. But look at Astan looking over their shoulder. They're all trying to figure out what do we do with our man, Alberto Contador.
Life at the back of the peloton now is that long, long line. Somebody in the middle will leave a door open soon. Champion of Spain is going off on the right of the picture, Gutierrez. They're all starting to drop away now. Also going here is Johan van Summen, the big man on the Garmin transition team. Sylvain Chavanel, two stage wins and two yellow jerseys. Seems like it was last year, but it was in the opening week of the Tour de France. Plushin going off as well. George Hincapie is up front, he's going off too.
Well, they're being tailed off one by one. These riders now just wanting to survive this final day in the Pyrenees. Four massive stages we've had, and still Cancellara dishing out the pain at the front end. Look at the face on Chris Anker Sorensen. He hasn't even come to the front to do his turn yet.
Just working on the cool back wheel here of Cancellara. But how long can Cancellara keep this pace up for? They're trying to springboard their man into the lead, but every time we tick off a kilometre, time is running out for Andy Schleck. How long is he going to wait before he makes a move?
I just noticed that rider Heijerdahl from Garmin transitioned. He'd move up to around about 15th, 20th place in this group. This is the damage at the back. There's the world champion, Cadel Evans. He can't stay in the field this afternoon.
Yes, you've got to feel sorry for Cadel Evans. He's determined to finish this Tour de France, but he rides with that broken elbow. He's in terrible pain, and there he is. He's a world champion. World champions don't give up.
No, they certainly don't, and that's why he wants to stay in the Tour de France this afternoon, not just for himself and the team, but all of the fans who've turned out to watch him and who've turned on the television channels all over the world to see the world champion race in the Tour de France.
Thomas Lockfist, best place of Sky, just been dropped by the peloton as well.
Well, they're looking down here. These look like the shoes of Marcus Burkhardt, and there he is. He is in second place just behind Kolobnev, number 74. They are still holding on, Phil, to about a 2.5-minute advantage over the front end of the main field. They've lost a huge chunk of time over the last 2 or 3 kilometres.
15 kilometres left for the peloton. The 0.8 of a kilometre behind the leaders on the road here now. These are desperate moments. I can't see them surviving. At the end of the day, the best men in the Tour de France are going to rise to the top by the finish.
Look at Cancellara. He stopped at the side of the road there. He pushed himself to his absolute limit for the team to try and set something up. Now it's Chris Anker Sorensen. After him, it's going to be Fulsgang. But Lance Armstrong is actually still in this group.
There's Cancellara now as he drops off the back of the main field now. To him, it's get home. No worry. No problems with the time delay. Job done.
Well, that's it, job done, but he really put a lot of pressure onto this group because look how many riders are left here. There's not very many in this group at all.
It's a very small group and it's very selected. Keep your eyes on the man in the white jersey because he has got to attack and he's got to gain time. Contador in yellow, these are the two leaders here. Marvellous crowd on the slopes of the Col du Tourmalet. They had to walk here. There's no way they were allowed by the police to bring vehicles.
But look at the way that Kolobnev is riding there, Phil. He knows that he's got a good chance here of creating a bit of history this afternoon, and that's why he's going up the front, setting the pace with Marcus Burkhardt. But look at the faces of the riders in this group. This is the most important group, really, this afternoon.
Jürgen van den Broek trailed by Matthew Lloyd there, the Australian on the same team. Now, Contador has got right in behind the white jersey of Schleck. Schleck always looks like he's smiling when, in fact, he's grimacing. And he's right at the front. It's his team doing the work. These boys are dodging each other now because Marcus Burkhardt is really giving this his best shot.
Well, it's a great move. I'm not sure whether they will survive because we will still see a massive battle. But as long as they stay off the front, they can still nurture a hope of surviving to the top of this climb. Face of Chris Anker Sorensen now really dishing out the pain. But Kolobnev has gone and Burkhardt has cracked.
Well, he waited, he just took himself into the red zone and Kolobnev has decided to push on himself now. Well, he's the only man to survive. He's the last chance for the breakaway of seven to get first to the summit. And he's holding the peloton. It's locked in at 2:31.
Well, what a coup this would be for Katusha if they got this memorable stage this afternoon. He's riding his first Tour de France here, but I tell you what, he's not a rider who doesn't know how to go up hills because he was pretty dominant, I have to say, Phil. I'm not sure what's going on here because we're looking over his shoulder. A little chat there between Andy Schleck and the team car.
But as the peloton are still being paced by Andy Schleck's teammate here, there's still no signs of an attack coming from Schleck.
Alexander Vinokourov sitting at the back end of the main field now, and he's under a little bit of difficulty this afternoon, but he wants to stay there as long as possible. Good to see that Armstrong is still in there, the old man of the sport at 38 years of age. He is already, Phil, still in a very select group of riders.
This is incredible, the speed they are climbing the Col du Tourmalet here. They're sat at the back there, Alexander Vinokourov, but still the question mark remains, when will Andy Schleck attack? Look at the speed of these boys hitting the mountain now. This is incredible. If only you could see or feel the slopes here as they climb the mountains. There is Boysenhagen, swept up by the peloton now. Takes a look at the men who has caused the pain that took him out of the break.
Probably thinking to himself, I'm glad I don't have to go through that kind of pain, because you can see pain written over all of the faces of these riders now in the big showdown we've been waiting. Joachim Rodriguez is there as well for Katusha, just sitting on the back wheel of Alberto Contador.
Well, you can never tell what Alberto's thinking. His face never shows anything, and the same at the moment has to be said for Andy Schleck. The attack's got to come soon.
There, you might just have caught a glimpse of the rider with the orange jersey on, and that is Denny Menshov. Roman Krutziger now looking to try and ride a very good Tour de France. He promised to finish up in the top 10 overall, but he too struggled a fraction for Team Liquigas, as Vandenbroek hopes to stay in the top five.
Vinokourov sat at the back here. This man has had a wonderful Tour de France, now riding, of course, in defence of Contador. Right now, he looks as though he may just be hanging on the back of this very select lead bunch. Terrific riding by Chris Anker-Sorensen, but how long can he keep this up?
Well, that is a big question. I wonder whether or not he's assassinating his own teammate, Andy Schleck, here, because this is an incredible tempo that they're dishing out.
And there he is going, you know.
It looks as if Alexander Vinokourov is paying. Bear in mind, he rode this year the Giro d'Italia. And, Phil, let's not forget, he started the day in ninth place overall. He could be losing his top 10 finish.
Well, in one way, it's good news for Hayes Jadal of Canada, because he will move over. He's only, in fact, 30-odd seconds behind Vinokourov. That's well bridgeable now by rider Hayes Jadal, because he is in this group right now.
Well, he's riding comfortably in it. I've seen him a couple of times, but we are assassinating everybody here. And I think the tactic here from Team Saxo Bank is to try and asphyxiate Team Astana. I'm trying to have a quick look and figure out how many riders from Astana are in this group. I think he still has two teammates, Alberto Contador.
Well, I'll tell you what, this is the reversal of tactics by Saxo Bank. They have destroyed the demon pacemaking of Astana here. There's Navarro going through. He's just riding in front of Contador, but he's got Schleck on his wheel as well. It gets very steep towards the end, this, but I feel that Schleck has got to split this field up. He's got to attack soon. He's running out of road at 12 kilometres to the summit.
Well, you know, I have a feeling there may well only be one teammate in this group for Alberto Contador, and that's Daniel Navarro. This is the damage that's being done at the back. This is Monnier, one of the young riders from Cofidis. In front of him, Steve Morabito, the rider from BMC, brought into this team to look after the interests of Cadel Evans.
In all honesty, I don't think it matters now, because we're on the last climb of the Tour. There's Samuel Sanchez. He's probably suffering just by very breathing on this climb right now because of the crash he had. And he hurt his sternum. He's also got a rather nasty cut on his right arm, but he's still there. He's holding third at the moment. Just in front of him, rider Hayes Jadal is there. The king of the mountains elect is in the group as well, and that is Anthony Chateau.
Well, now Chris Anker-Sorensen has disappeared from the front. His job done for the day. He will now just try and put it into reverse gear and try and survive on these last few kilometres up to the top. It's up to Fulsgaard, the young guy from Team Saxo Bank. He's riding his first Tour de France, and he's wondering whether or not he can be the launch pad for Andy Schleck. Krutzig is moving forward as well there. Look at Matty Lloyd. This is a phenomenal performance. It's his second Grand Tour of the year, Phil, and he won the King of the Mountains earlier on in the Giro d'Italia.
There's the King of the Mountains elect now, Anthony Chateau, which went chasing all the small points on this year's Tour de France, and he could well be the King of the Mountains tonight in the race. And also in this group too, Levi Leipheimer said he'd give it his best shot today and see just if he could match Contador and Schleck. And he's still in this group along with Lance Armstrong and Chris Horner. They're doing the team lead no harm at all.
Well, I'll tell you what, Phil, we're only halfway up the climb and it's already been an exciting race. And let's not forget that Alexander Kolobnev is still leading the yellow jersey group by over 2 minutes. He is making a phenomenal performance. But look at this, coming into the wings now, Denny Menchov right in the middle there, alongside him his teammate, that's Robert Gesink.
We're looking straight into the eyes of the yellow jersey. He's still sat on the wheel on the Col du Tourmalet of the white jersey, Andy Schleck. Neither has raised a pedal in anger. Their teammates are still setting the pace. 11 and a half kilometres to climb. The Russian, Alexander Kolomnev, the only survivor of seven, is pushing on, and he's still got 2 minutes. We're in Barej.
He's just coming through the town of Barej. He's got himself into the zone. He's just got to keep riding as if it's an individual time trial for him now. He gets out of the saddle as we go a bit further back and look into the face of Jürgen Vandenbroek, who's got a very strong ally in Matty Lloyd, former Australian national champion, but champion of the King of the Mountains at the Giro d'Italia, and a great man to have alongside you.
Well, all of Belgium will be loving these pictures right now as Jürgen Vandenbroek sits on second wheel here. The Saxo Bank riders are almost done for. Then who's going to set the pace? That's got to be the key for Schleck to go.
Well, Sylvester Schmidt is in here for Liquigas. He's looking after the interests of his teammate behind him, Roman Krutziger. Kiryenka there, the man who almost got himself a victory onto the road in Gap. And how long ago does that seem? He's looking very comfortable for Case Depagne. But in the team race, Team Radio Shack have got four riders in this group.
But these are incredible pictures here. Contador just sitting there at the moment. We're now seeing the John Gadray unhitch at the back as well. He came in for a shower of criticism of Stephen Rhodes when he left his son Nicholas on the roadside when he was riding for a personal place the other day. But this is all about the who will win the Tour de France now. Off the back goes Verdugo, the man that stood by the roadside to get Sanchez back in the race earlier.
Konstantin Sivtsov going back there for HTC Colombia. Here's a Juan Antonio Fletcher has a chance to look and see what it looks like at the front of the main field in the Tour de France for the yellow jersey group.
The Col du Tourmalet signed on the left of the road. The leader is a Russian cyclist. Alexander Kolomnev comes up through the village here of Barej. A massive, massive crowd. He's still got time on his side, 1:03. He's got 11 kilometres to climb. There's no respite now. And where these boys are getting the strength from at this sort of speed, I really don't know. So they continue to ride and put pressure on. When the Saxo Bank pull off the front, it'll be a free-range fight between them all.
Welcome back. Andy Schleck has finally attacked, and Alberto Contador's gone with him. The race is breaking up behind them, but the race for the yellow jersey has finally begun. No more breaks now until this race ends.
Well, we're looking at every man for himself now as we come up at 9.5 kilometres to ride. Robert Gesink here is joining the counter-attack here from Andy Schleck, if he can, because right up the road now is the big move. The white jersey is attacked with the yellow jersey on his wheel. And Samuel Sanchez here is trying to reach it. But this is where the Tour de France lies right now. They are 21 seconds behind the last survivor of those seven men, Kolobnev. And this man, Schleck, has not really attacked Contador. He's tried to ride him off his wheel.
That's a tough thing to do, but he's made it as tough as possible. I tell you what, all of a sudden, that one-minute advantage that Kolobnev have just got wiped away, and it's all because of this man in the white jersey, the man who starts today in second place overall. He's only looking for 8 seconds, and what he wants to do today is try and turn the books around to get himself a grip on that yellow jersey.
The white jersey of number 11, the number that Stephen Rhodes rode in 1987 to victory in the Tour de France. And now can Andy Schleck get his hands on that yellow jersey? He's 8 seconds off it. He needs it before the top today to start last in the time trial. Do you think Contador doesn't know that? Contador has not really attacked in this Tour de France, apart from the instance down into the finish the other day. He has just followed because he knows he's the master of the time trial.
He looks concentrated there. He knows that all he has to do is match the man in front of him. He's just got to keep an eye on him. Schleck is accelerating a fraction here, trying to break.
Well, this is what Contador used to do. He doesn't look in any trouble yet. Remember that Contador, although he leads this race, hasn't won any of the stages. He won't want to go to Paris without winning one. And the last one he can win, really, is probably today. The lone figure of Kolobnev on the horizon. Then the top two in the Tour de France. head up the cast as we head up to the top of the Tourmalet.
Well, they're very shortly going to be onto the coattail of this man, Alexander Kolobnev. He might have dreamed for a fraction of a time that he was going to win this stage this afternoon, but he must have known, Phil, there was going to be a huge battle behind him. And there they are in second and third place on the road for the moment. Shortly, it'll be first and second.
And this chase group behind, which still contains the top two riders, Menchov here, and has been joined by rider Hazerdal, the pacemaking being done by Sanchez. Hazerdal could be going up inside the top eight riders tonight with this performance.
Yeah, because Levi Leipheimer has been tailed off, and it could well be that the Canadian will climb up into eighth place. He has been a phenomenal performer. What amazes me is the freshness that rider Hazerdal has at the start every morning. Andy Schleck is riding like a man possessed. He has got nothing to lose this afternoon, Phil. All he's got to try and do is see if he can grab back that yellow jersey. And all Contador has to do is ride defensively.
8.5 kilometres from the summit of the Col du Tourmalet. They get alongside and pass and drop the Russian rider, Alexander Kolobnev. He's the champion of Russia. He's got no answer to these two. This has become a personal battle now. The Tour de France is a sideshow. Schleck versus Contador.
Well, we'd always said it was going to come down to the big show here. Contador just out of the saddle in his typical style as he sits and tries to stay in contact with Andy Schleck. I have to say, take my hat off to number 181, because Sammy Sanchez is dreaming of holding on to his third place overall. He had a very nasty crash, got himself back into the race, but the man who's his biggest danger is right behind him there, Denny Menchov, fourth at the start of the day.
And sitting there and look rather untroubled here. Sanchez needs more time. He's only 13 seconds ahead of Menchov. Menchov will ride a quicker time trial if he goes according to form. That would convince probably Menchov as being the man for Paris on Sunday. But which one's going to win the race on Sunday? If Schleck doesn't get a gap on the boy in yellow, he won't.
Well, he has to keep throwing accelerations at him. The climb now, Phil, very, very rarely goes less than 8% gradient all the way to the top of this climb. I'm just hoping we climb out of the mist here, because it, strangely enough, it's a little bit sunny outside, and this rain and mist seems to stay in the valley right down below us.
These people, as you can see with all the clothes, are pretty cold out there, because when the mist is there, temperatures drop to around 10 degrees Celsius or 50 degrees Fahrenheit. These two boys, there'll be no attack coming from Contador except to win the day, because he'll want the stage.
He would love to win this stage. This is a legendary stage, and all he has to do is stay in contact with Andy Schleck. Schleck kicking once again. Robert Gesink is doing the majority of the pacemaking in the group behind for Rabobank and for his own teammate, Denny Menchov.
Well, I'm not sure this is the way to calm Contador. Andy Schleck is just keeping a high pace. He's not putting Contador in difficulty. Schleck needs a few accelerations here, and he needs them really from behind Contador.
Well, that's what he wants to do, but he wonders, he probably thinks in the back of his mind that he can break Contador. You can't break a man like Alberto Contador. Contador just sitting there waiting to see whether or not this man in front of him has got the pressure, got the acceleration to really put him into difficulty.
He's only the fifth cyclist in the world to have won all three Grand Tours, France, Italy and Spain, Alberto Contador. And he hasn't won them by falseness. He's won them by being the very, very best.
He is a huge class act, Alberto Contador. He's ridden very well throughout this tour. He has been at the front end when he needed to be. He defended himself over the cobblestone section on the road to the forest of Arenberg, where everybody thought he could very easily lose minutes.
Well, don't forget, over the cobblestones, he finished behind Andy Schleck because of a broken spoke on the run into the finish. And now Contador is in the lead. 7.3 kilometres left to climb. They know this mountain so, so well.
Well, Contador just dancing away there. Doesn't seem to be in any difficulty at all, as Andy Schleck, just the face of concentration on the Luxembourger here, who just wants to get this bike race out of the way. He wants to get to the top of this climb as quickly as he possibly can. 7.2 kilometres to go to the top, 4.5 miles. Doesn't sound very far, does it?
It's an incredible piece of riding by them both here. It's hard to see the slopes in the mist of this climb. We will start hairpinning our way up as we break out of the cloud line, as we head towards the finish line.
Andy Schleck just sitting and tapping out the tempo, and he's got right on his wheel and his slipstream there. Alberto Contador, the Spanish, Well, in fact, no, that's a Luxembourger alongside, and he's shouting to Andy Schleck. He wants Andy Schleck to try and do something special if he can.
This is like the old days when Poulidor took on Anquetil shoulder to shoulder on the Puy de Dôme, and Poulidor never realised he had Anquetil on the ropes and didn't put it home. Now, I wonder if Schleck has got Contador on the ropes and doesn't realise it.
Well, he hasn't even dared to look back at him, and he knows that Alberto Contador is a great individual time trialist. He may well rival Fabian Cancellara in the individual time trial. He beat Cancellara in the final time trial last year, but this is going to be a different ball game when we go out to Bordeaux. But this is about the mountain, the mountain of the Pyrenees, the Col du Tourmalet.
There's something eerie. We're racing in a mist with visibility down so low. It's a bizarre scene. Millions of people cheering on two cyclists high in the sky bordering France with Spain. They'll come out of this cloud and they'll ride to glory in sunshine. But who will ride to glory in sunshine? Which one?
Well, that's the big question. Neither rider for the moment, Phil, showing any sign of weakness at all. Andy Schleck has said he will throw caution to the wind this afternoon. These guys are seriously on the defensive. Gesink doing the pacemaking at the front with Jürgen Vandenbroek.
So, as the chase continues here, they've been in the saddle 4¾ hours and we're still no closer to know who will win the Tour de France. There they go. Contador just dances on those pedals as he has done around the world of cycling to make the biggest victories of the moment. Schleck just wants that yellow jersey back.
He is itching to get it, but, you know, to do so, he's got to drop that man. And I'm not sure that he can, although Alberto Contador now looks to be suffering a fraction, but who wouldn't suffer to climb up the Col du Tourmalet?
White versus yellow. No red jersey here, probably just as well right now. As we look back to the group here, this is now Gesink on the front. I can't see anymore. No, yes, it is Gesink, because there's Menchov on the back. Kolobnev is hanging on in there. Or is this Rodriguez? It's Rodriguez. I'm losing track.
No, it was Kolobnev.
In the mist.
Kolobnev was still back
that
there
was
in
Kolobnev,
the mist.
Holding on, yes, been passed.
Go, Andy Schleck, the sign says at the side of the road, and there's the yellow jersey, and that'll be the Spaniards supporting their man, number one, Alberto Contador, looking for his fifth Grand Tour win and his third Tour de France victory. And all he has to do is stay in contact with the Luxembourger.
Well, this is almost insane. It's such a wonderful atmosphere here. The crowd, who've waited for 3 days, are now getting rid of all that excess energy, shouting these two riders up. The very two riders they expected to see. Showdown on the Col du Tourmalet.
What a magnificent way Andy Schleck has taken this race to Alberto Contador. He's doing everything that he can. He doesn't care, Andy Schleck, this afternoon, Phil, whether he cracks or not, because as far as he's concerned, it's win or lose, and that's what it's all about.
The camera focuses on 181. Samuel Sanchez on the ground, left behind earlier today, suffering with a very painful sternum and a damaged right elbow, still holding on to his third place overall. These two have left everybody behind them now. The chase group consists of Clodin, Morabito, Roland Sanchez. They're also behind. It's a very complicated pattern on the road behind these two riders.
What a face on this man. There's no question about tactics now, Phil. It's just a question of survival of the fittest. The man who is the freshest in this last week of the race. The man who's got the ability to push himself through the pain barrier for one final time in the Pyrenees this year.
Well, the Basque flag there waves at Contador. They continue to go up towards the summit here, side by side. No attempt at all by Alberto Contador to do anything at all. He's going to follow Andy Schleck as long as he can, which will probably be to the top, the way he's riding right now.
Well, Schleck is just stamping out that rhythm, and he's extending his lead over everybody else behind him, and that might be important too, because he could need a very big buffer over Denny Menchov when it comes to the individual time trial. But I think more importantly, what he's looking for is to try and put Alberto Contador against the ropes, and I'm not sure he's going to be able to do that.
5.5 kilometres still to climb. We saw this the other day in the mountains. They came to a virtual standstill because Schleck was fed up of leading Alberto Contador. But it's all down to Schleck to do something about it, and he might well ease up in a minute and try to start and jump him.
Well, I don't think there's going to be any slowing down now. This race is going to go all out right to the top, but he does need to try and attack him and lift his pace. But, you know, Alberto Contador has the ability to change his pace so many times on the slope of a climb. Johan Brunel always said the special thing about Contador is his ability to attack. This is Nicholas Roach, and I have to tell you, I don't really know where he is because I can't see very much through the mist.
Well, I'll tell you where he is listed on our computer screens. He's not listed at all at the moment. He might well be in the third place on the road, but as far as we know, it's Horner, Kreuzinger, Hejedal, Rodriguez, Van den Broek, Sanchez, Menchoff, and Gesink in that very select chase group, and they're already a minute and 16 seconds behind these two.
Well, there's no request at all from Andy Schleck to Alberto Contador to come forward and do any of the pacemaking, and Schleck is just going for it here this afternoon. Contador, all he has to do is just stay there. It's a difficult thing to do, but at least you've got to take your hat off to Andy Schleck for trying.
They're about to see 5 kilometres to go here on the Col du Tourmalet. That's 3 miles left to the summit. It gets harder, it gets narrower, and the twists and turns a lot more. And this is where Andy has got to try and open the gap. There it is, 5 kilometres to the summit.
That's going to take them an awful long way to get to the top of this climb, but Andy Schleck continues to tamp out that very vicious pace.
The two leaders are just inside, 5 kilometres to climb. They're in the heaviest cloud of the moment. They'll come out of it before the finish, and all they'll see when they come out of it is a very, very steep twisting road to the summit of the Col du Tourmalet. And no, Contador will not go past Andy Schleck. It's up to Schleck to lose him.
Well, it's up to Schleck to try and rip the yellow jersey off the shoulders of Alberto Contador. He's done everything he can. And what a great job of work done by Team Saxo back to set this up. And Andy Schleck is kicking again.
Remember, Schleck needs 9 seconds to get the yellow, so he starts last in the time trial on Saturday. He has said, if I don't start last in the time trial, there's no way I will ever beat Alberto Contador on Saturday. It's very important he knows what Contador is doing in front of him in the time trial.
And that's what he wants to do, but he's not going to do it like this. He needs to just keep accelerating. He needs to go back a fraction and then jump once again. The crowd are going crazy here as we go through the mist, and I wonder if they will climb out of the mist at all. Just inside of 3 miles to go to the finish. This is a phenomenal work that Andy Schleck is doing on the front end of the race.
He's increased the tempo here, and Contador's matching him. They will climb out of the mist, believe me, as they continue. The flag of Australia waving there. Be a little bit of a wait today, I'm afraid, for Cadel Evans. But as you look at these two now, if you can just see the face here of Schleck, this is hurting him. Contador is just concentrating and answering the call of Schleck's pedals.
Well, they've got a good 1 minute and 20 seconds over the chase group behind them, which is a chase group containing all of the riders up in the top 10 overall, apart from Levi Leipheimer, who seems to have faltered, but he's been replaced by his own teammate, Chris Horner, who is in that group with Kreuziger, Hejedal, Rodriguez, Vandenbroek. Sanchez is still there with Menchoff and Gesink.
Now he looks over his shoulder. That's the bad sign. Here comes the slowdown. He knows that he hasn't got rid of high-speed tempo riding, has not got rid of Contador. We're looking soon in about a third of a kilometre for 4 to go. Time is running out for Andy Schleck here, and the crowd are getting deeper by the inch.
Well, he was looking to see whether he's got that final little bit of acceleration as they start to get that bit steeper up the climb. Just about 4 kilometres to go.
Is this the shutdown by Andy Schleck? Is he a little bit disheartened by the fact that Contador has not given him an inch on that back wheel? The crowd are shouting them through. The adrenaline must pour. They are riding almost side by side to the 4 kilometre sign here in the final mountain stage of the tour. And as Contador will not go by him, he's just hanging on in there. Schleck is now beginning to look a little bit confused.
Well, he's looking into the face of Alberto Contador to see if he can see any sign of weakness. But so far, Alberto Contador hasn't shown any sign of weakness at all. Andy Schleckville has to continue with the path that he's decided to choose here this afternoon. There is no turning back.
The white jersey of Schleck, the best young rider. The crowd are shouting into the ears of Contador. These people are all Spanish. They're not French. They can go over the hill and go home anytime they want to. They're here to see the Spanish rider keep his yellow jersey.
Contador's going.
And he's gone. And is Schleck going to answer that one? I'm not sure he can, because this is going to be a massive attack. Andy Schleck, though, has got all of the courage that has come to him in this Tour de France. Look at that. He's back on him.
Well, he's not quite on him, but he's digging very deep indeed, and that was a very vicious acceleration by Alberto Contador, but slowly the Luxembourger has clawed his way back.
Well, really, Contador should turn around and shake his hand, because that was a superb recovery. I think there might have even been a word there, because look now at Schleck staring into the eyes of Contador, as if to say, you sat on me all the way up and you thought you could get rid of me.
That was a stare right into the face of Alberto Contador by Andy Schleck. Not only is he trying to get the yellow jersey this afternoon, Phil, he wants to win this stage as well, because this is a stage of legends. 100 years ago, the Tour de France included the Col du Tourmalet, and Andy Schleck knows all about history.
Well, it's a long, long time since we've seen two cyclists of virtually equal ability here, as they ride side by side, separated by a mechanical problem to Schleck, otherwise they might still be locked in a duo battle.
Well, that would be a real battle on the final time trial if they'd gone in with that, a difference of 31 seconds. However, it's 8 seconds advantage to Alberto Contador. I wonder if he's going to try again, because he probably will be a bit disheartened. You know, last year when Alberto Contador attacked on the slopes of a climb, he went clear from everybody. This year, it's a little bit different.
Well, Contador must have been pretty surprised there that Schleck had that power still in his legs, because it really was a quick reaction by Schleck. We're going to be out of the mist soon now. We'll be at 3 kilometres to go. These two boys could well go to the line side by side. How fitting would that be?
And if you remember when we went back to the time when Andy Schleck followed Alberto Contador because he said he didn't think he could respond to the surprise attacks, well, he responded to that one perfectly.
100 years of climbing the Col du Tourmalet. Well, they paid homage to the mountain today with one of the greatest climbs by two riders in the history of the Tour.
This has been an incredible battle, and Andy Schleck will not give up at all. I wonder if Contador thinks he's got one last acceleration in those legs of his this afternoon at 3K to go.
3 kilometres, 1.8 miles to the end of the mountains in the Tour de France. It won't be the end of the Tour. There's 3 more days to go, and there is a crucial time trial to come on Saturday. These two boys go up like Siamese twins.
Well, the Spanish flags now are waving there, hoping their man can come up with a victory on this top of the Col du Tourmalet. They also want him to take the yellow jersey all the way up to Paris. Andy Schleck has ridden like a man possessed this afternoon. He's a real fighter, and he will fight all the way up to the top of this climb, and he'll still hope that he's going to get himself a victory. Got himself tangled in the Basque flag there. Please don't let that falsify the race.
Well, the Vikings have landed. They found the Col du Tourmalet. It's taken them 100 years, but there they are, as Andy Schleck now looks out here for Luxembourg. Nobody has climbed in a race from Luxembourg in this race since the great Charlie Gall, who coined the image the Angel of the Mountain.
Well, I'm not sure about the guys on the left-hand side of the road.
Well, they're very brave men in these weather conditions, I can tell you.
So I think they're trying to emulate Borac from a couple of years ago. But anyway, more importantly, back to the race. Schleck's face shows all of the concentration he needs, while further down the road, at around about a minute and 20, Robert Gesink is trying to keep his man, Denny Menchov, right up in the overall standings. And just tacked on the back there, I'm just looking, I think is, yes, he is, Sammy Sanchez.
But also another superb piece of riding coming out of Chris Horner after that long breakaway the other day before when we went into Poe, moved him up to 14th place overall. This man could be moving into the top 10 tonight. Moving forward with rider Heijerdahl. So there's the clean bottle. We knew he'd get in on the axe somewhere. Dave's running up the mountain again today, but he can't keep up with these two. They're side by side. Can Schleck do one more attack?
Well, I'm not sure he's got it in him. You know, he's really done everything. He's done all of the pacemaking. All Contador has had to do, Phil, is watch one man. That's the way it's been for these four big mountain stages. All he needed to do was watch Andy Schleck and just stay there. And that's what he's done on this climb. He's just sat in his slipstream. He tried to drop him, but he couldn't.
Well, do you think the Tour de France ended right now on the Col du Tourmalet? It does not. There are 3 more days to come. Tomorrow we might be talking about people like Mark Cavendish winning again down into Bordeaux. And then there's a time trial to come and the final day to Paris, which will be more or less a ceremony and a respectful salute to whoever does win this race. But these two boys have been the very, very best. And Schleck, what a competitor.
Well, just telling you now, a computer's just coming through and letting me know where Nicholas Roach is. He's actually currently riding in 11th place on the road, so he wasn't too far off making the junction with that group in front of him. And that's a phenomenal ride by him. He'll be climbing up as well at the end of the day, maybe also up into a top 15th place.
2 kilometres to the summit of the Col du Tourmalet now. It doesn't get any easier, believe me, it gets a bit more twistier. And Schleck has made no effort to try another attack.
Well, you know, all he can do now, Phil, is to stamp out this very vicious tempo that he's dictated since around about the moment they left the city of the town of Barège. Out of the saddle, Contador comes up alongside him just to show him that he's still there and he's not going anywhere.
There has to be one more attack from Andy Schleck. He has to try and get 8 seconds. He's lifted the tempo again, but he's going to have to go with a big sprint and a big surge because Contador is not even ruffled here.
No, not at all. He's just sitting there allowing the Luxembourger to do the pacemaking. I don't think Andy Schleck's got one more acceleration left in those legs of his, but he's still dreaming. He's still dreaming about one thing, Phil. If he can't get rid of Alberto Contador, he wants to try and get him the stage victory.
It looks like they're bringing the cloud with them here, but the finish is still okay as Schleck continues to climb. Clear road ahead now. Contador has the best position just to follow Schleck. This is all he ever had to do. He knew it, but he did try to drop him and he failed.
Well, Lisa, I hope these spectators don't get too close because I don't want to see an accident to either of these two riders at the front end of the main field. Schleck is still dishing out the work to Alberto Contador, who just sits there. I would have thought that if Contador was feeling pretty good, he'd come to the front and try and show to Andy Schleck that he's got the legs this afternoon.
Well, Contador wants the stage win. Yellow jerseys are supposed to win stages, and he hasn't got one yet. And he will go for the win, even though he hasn't helped Schleck all the way up here. That is for sure. And he's got now 1.4 kilometres to the summit. The road doesn't get any easier at all. It stays quite steep as we twist, and it gets narrow too.
Well, these two are locked together as we expected they would be. They have been locked together since they left the town of Barège. The picture of the face of Andy Schleck here is what it's all about this afternoon. He's dishing out as much pain as he can, but you can't ride a man like Alberto Contador off your wheel.
Well, one thing's for certain now, Andy Schleck's fan club will take a boost in membership after his ride up this mountain. This is Rodriguez further down the mountain. This is the next group, which contains a Kreuzinger, Hejedor. Horner is here, Vandenbroek is here, Sanchez.
Well, Kreuziger actually just going off the back a fraction there as Joachim Rodriguez there puts the hammer down.
But if Kreuziger goes off the back, Nicholas Roach will be the next to see him on the way up. We're still with the leaders. If anything, the crowd has got, the fog has got a little bit worse here, but it's quite clear outside our commentary box.
Well, Andy Schleck still riding at the front, and now they're waiting for the final ultimo kilometro.
1 kilometer to the summit and the last climb in this year's Tour de France. The two men separated this morning by 8 seconds are not separated by any more than 8 seconds as they go into the last 900 meters.
Well, Andy Schleck now has got to try and get his head around the fact that he's got to try and outsprint Alberto Contador to at least get something back from the work that he's done in this breakaway this afternoon. Kiwi flag over to the right-hand side there, the Breton flag, the Norwegian flag, the Spanish flag, they're all out for these guys.
This is an atmosphere never before seen on the Col du Tourmalet, despite being in the Tour for 100 years. And can Contador even attack with a crowd like this? The only good news is the barriers will start soon and they'll be free to go one more time, head-to-head, as they race for the top. We literally finish on the very, very, very top of this mountain.
Well, Andy Schleck getting out of the saddle one more time, and there we've got the crowd off to the side. It's going to be a big preparation now for the final sprint to the top of the Col du Tourmalet.
The Japanese flag waits. The rising sun is right there as they go by. We're still in the mist here, but this will kick round again. It'll hairpin up towards the line. It is so, so steep at this point on the Tourmalet.
It's extremely steep in the corners of the Tourmalet now as the riders start to hug the left-hand side of the road, and still Alberto Contador has not come forward. He's going to bank everything, Phil, on the final acceleration up to the line. And I wonder if Andy Schleck has got anything at all left in those legs of his to try and get himself the victory.
Well, what is he? An absolute superman the way he's ridden today. 500 metres to go. That's all, and Contador is waiting. We'll come round the back. Maybe there are no barriers here, I don't know, because it's up the other side of the mountain from the way we came today because of the people. And just look at the people here. Now, what an image this is. The maillot jaune, the maillot blanc, and they're taking the race head-to-head, another hairpin right round, and that's a really steep corner. Contador, is he going to try and sprint for the line? Will he dare take the glory away from Schleck, who's been an absolute hero today? My answer is he will.
He will go for it if he can. He does not want to become the seventh rider in the history of the Tour de France to win the Tour without winning a single stage. Looking over 300 metres to go and still Contador sitting in second position.
I just thought for a moment he was going to ride shoulder to shoulder with Schleck and may the best man win, but no, Contador has dropped back here. It is so steep. And we're getting into the last 200 metres. Sooner or later, somebody's going to make a move.
Well, this is the this climb, Phil, goes right the way up to the summit. They can't see the banner. It's covered in mist. But still, we're looking at about 150 metres to go for Andy Schleck. And Contador's waiting to make that move.
It's got to come now. Of course, we're on the other side of the mountain and we're all literally in the sun. But they're going to finish this race in the fog at the top. They look at the finishing line. They can reach out and touch it. It's Schleck on the right, in case you can't see. Contador, they start the sprint side by side. And this is a huge effort. Alberto Contador, though, wants a stage win. And they're going to cross, and he's let Schleck take it. And so he should. That was incredible. Schleck wins. Contador takes second. Who will get third?
Well, it's a big battle for third now. But look at the average speed, Phil. 34 kilometres an hour has been the average speed of the day. That's 19 miles an hour. Robert Gesink is doing the pacemaking here behind, and he's got in his slipstream his own teammate, Denny Menchoff. The last time check I got was these guys were around about a minute and 40 seconds behind, and in the mist, I can't actually tell you who's left in this group, but I think I can just see the shape of Sammy Sanchez there in third. He's done a great performance for a man who was thrown to the ground in the early part of this stage.
Gesink. The Russian rider goes through in second place. Second there, third there is the great ride of Horner. This is Jürgen Vandenbroek. I haven't seen a yet rider Heijerdahl go through, but he must be just here.
Well, I think Heijerdahl may well have been tailed off just a fraction, as is Jürgen Vandenbroek about to get tailed off as well here. And Joachim Rodriguez is gone. We'd forgotten about him. He could well be holding on for third place.
Well, he's the rider who won in Monde. He's not too far behind overall, but he's not in the chance of doing it. He's lying in eighth place. He might move up a little bit closer tonight, gaining a bit of time. Huge effort by Joachim Rodriguez to take the third place finish.
Well, that was a great performance by him. In fact, Heijerdahl is in fourth, Phil, coming up to the finish line.
He's going to be in eighth tonight in the Tour de France, at least. Well done, rider Heijerdahl. He's confirmed himself as a top rider in this year's Tour de France.
Well, Sanchez, I don't know where Menchoff was. In fact, they tailed off Menchoff at the front of the top. Menchoff comes across the line now with his teammate Robert Gesink. So a few more seconds, Phil, grabbed there by Sammy Sanchez. Here's Jürgen Vandenbroek.
Well, they're coming over the final efforts. They've dug so deep into their souls to get up to the top, because the battle for the seconds exists through all of the places in the top 10 in this Tour de France. That's Roman Kreuzinger coming up now as he continues to climb. It's 2 minutes since Schleck got the better of Contador on the line, if that was the way it was. Either way, they didn't lose or gain a single second today.
Well, dramatic images as Kreuzinger crosses the line. I'm not quite sure which is the finish line there, Phil, the first one or the second one, because it's a diagonal line across the road.
But one was the other way when we came over yesterday or 2 days ago. Now this is the finish one right there.
Well, Andy Schleck there, I think he deserved that victory. He did all of the tempo pacemaking up to the summit of this climb. I don't think Alberto Contador dared to take the victory away from him.
Well, he punches the air there. He's quite clearly pleased with the victory, and so he should be, but he was unable to take a single second. That's the picture we want to see. Two great bike riders fighting it out to the last inch of the mountain.
What a battle that was. Well, I think that says it all there, Phil. There's Damiano Cunego, great.
At least, well done, rider Heijerdahl. He's confirmed himself as a top rider in this year's Tour de France.
Well, Sanchez, I don't know where Menchoff was. In fact, they tailed off Menchoff at the front of the top. Menchoff comes across the line now with his teammate Robert Gesink. So a few more seconds, Phil, grabbed there by Sammy Sanchez. Here's Jürgen Vandenbroek.
Well, they're coming over the final efforts. They've dug so deep into their souls to get up to the top, because the battle for seconds exists through all of the places in the top 10 in this Tour de France. That's Roman Kreuzinger coming up now as he continues to climb. It's 2 minutes since Schleck got the better of Contador on the line. If that was the way it was, either way, they didn't lose or gain a single second today.
Well, dramatic images as Kreuziger crosses the line. I'm not quite sure which is the finish line there, Phil, the first one or the second one, because it's a diagonal line across the road.
But one was the other way when we came over yesterday or 2 days ago. Now that is the finish one right there.
Well, Andy Schleck there, just I think he deserved that victory. He did all of the tempo pacemaking up to the summit of this climb. I don't think Alberto Contador dared to take the victory away from him.
Well, he punches the air there. He's quite clearly pleased with the victory, and so he should be, but he was unable to take a single second. That's the picture we want to see. Two great bike riders fighting it out to the last inch of the mountain.
What a battle that was. Well, I think that says it all there, Phil. There's Damiano Cunego, great ride by him. We have seen a big turnaround in the books. I'm not exactly sure if Nicholas Roach came in at all, but he was actually indicated as being just off the back of the Sanchez-Menchov group. So in the confusion there, Nicholas Roach may just have survived, and that will move him well up in the overall standings today. But look at the clock. 3 minutes and 20 seconds already have gone past. Here's Nicholas Roach.
Nicholas Roach now, and look at that face. As Nicholas Roach confirms himself there as a man who is making terrific progress. He's only a young rider in the Tour de France. He's right up there today. Looks like John Gadre just coming over the line there.
Well, Nicholas Roach proving who is the leader of that team anyway. Next man to come in. Well, I'm not quite sure who that is. Rider from HTC. It could be Siftsov, because he was in the group for a lot longer than Mickey Rogers was.
Can't see anybody else it could be. And Carlos Barredo.
What a great ride by him.
And this is Lance Armstrong coming up now ahead of Levi Leipheimer, as far as we know. 4 minutes, 5 seconds behind. He tops his final mountain in any Tour de France. Armstrong is home.
Well, that's a pretty impressive performance there. Just looking to see, there is Barredo coming in as well. Time ticking by here this afternoon.
There's no doubt that Armstrong would have been again very close to the podium in Paris, but for all of his crashes and bad luck in the opening days of this tour.
Kirienka, Luis Leon Sanchez coming in.
Well, they've lost a little bit of ground in the team race. We're looking for the third counter for Radio Shack, but with Horner being right up in that move, he's given them a good overall advantage, I think, in the team.
Well, just looking down there, I think they've had three finishes for Radio Shack, because Andreas Kloden has come across the line in 13th place. So could see them consolidating their lead in that team classification. Real big move there by Nicholas Roach. He's finishing 12th, and he will move well up in the overall standings.
Haven't seen Horner come in, and that's, Leipheimer come in. And he could be losing his sixth place overall tonight. He went off pretty early on the climb.
Yeah, he will probably drop down the overall standings here this afternoon, but he could very well be replaced in the top 10 by Chris Horner,
who's
in a storming ride.
I said sixth also, I meant seventh he was at the start of the day, Levi Leipheimer. But Rodriguez will certainly go over him now. There's Nicolas Sarkozy, the president of France. He witnessed the whole thing firsthand today. He is an absolute enthusiast of cycling in general and the Tour de France in particular.
Well, Phil, this is how it all happened. The great acceleration after being set up by this team, Saxo Bank. It was all to do about Andy Schleck on the slopes of the Col du Tourmalet. He did everything he could to try and wrest that yellow jersey away from Alberto Contador, but the Spaniard was just too good.
He paced him all the way up the Tourmalet the minute his teammates finished. Then came this attack, and it's normally a winner. This is the killer blow by Alberto Contador. But you just can't kill off Andy Schleck. He dug deep. Took a little second to get into gear, and then he was right on him, locked in. He wasn't going nowhere, so they stopped.
And that's pretty impressive when you know just how hard he must have dug into his reserves to set the tempo nearly all the way up this climb, with Alberto Contador for the majority of the climb in second position. But finally, Andy Schleck got what he wanted to. He got that victory just over the top. And as I said, Phil, I'm not sure that Alberto Contador dared to try and challenge him.
No, he gave him the victory, and rightly so today.
So the next thing we'll be waiting for an awful long time for a lot of riders to come to the top. Anthony Chateau, by the way, he's just crossed the line in 27th place, so he will be crowned tonight the winner of the King of the Mountains classification. There are no more mountains left in the Tour this year. As we look there, incredible images there at the top. So there's confirmation. of the current overall standings. Alberto Contador still leads Andy Schleck by 8 seconds. Sammy Sanchez is down to 3:32. Denny Menchov fourth at 3:53, and Jürgen Vandenbroek stays inside of the top five.
71 kilometres still to ride today. They've kept themselves up on that reasonable pace all throughout, and the poor four riders who broke away at the start today, about 12 kilometres in, have really just been pegged out there to sweat it out. 2 minutes and 18 seconds is the gap now. The most it ever got was 3 minutes 40 after about 45 kilometres of racing. They're quite clearly of the opinion, we can take you when we want you.
No, I think that's the way it is, and there's a different way of having a look at the race profile. They're putting the race map out there as well to look at, and that's Française-des-Jeux. I didn't catch a glimpse, but I think that was Marc Madio sitting in the back seat, and he is one of the team managers who decides not to drive or sit in the passenger seat. He'd rather be in the back seat of the car so he can have a look at the television and drive in a safe manner and try and figure out how to develop the tactics as the race evolves.
Seems to make common sense to me, but I know a lot of team managers do prefer to drive, so they're in complete control of what happens. Looking here at the youngster Daniel Oss, who made a big impression this year as a lead-out man, and so they've given him his shot at the Tour de France. A very good amateur cyclist, especially on the track. And now he's in his first Tour de France. He's only 23 years of age, and he's got a big future. And his team, Leaky Gas, are having a stellar season this year. They're winning a lot of races around the world.
No, they certainly are. They've had a great amount of success in all of the races they've participated in, but yet maybe not quite the success they were looking for from the Tour de France. Their best-placed rider is Roman Krutziger in ninth place overall, but he is in third place in the best young rider competition, and Krutziger is around about 10 minutes behind Alberto Contador. The front end of the main field very much dominated and controlled here by Alessandro Petacchi's team Lamprey. Pataki will sit at the back end of that line. He will make sure that his team do all of the work necessary. There's Alexander Vinokourov coming through. That is Jose Rojas. There's the German champion, Christian Knies, Swiss champion going through there as well. These guys at the moment pretty much having a recuperation day, but it won't be recuperation once we get down to the last 30 or 40 kilometres. The average speed of the race in the third hour was 40.3 kilometres an hour, but the first 3 hours of the race have actually been run off at a fairly rapid average speed of 42 kilometres an hour.
I mean, well, just look at the length of the peloton, Paul, and the sharp end is a straight line. Little bit of a bulge in the middle, like the snake's had a morning meal, and then the tail comes out at the other end as well. No, that's the sign of a tough race.
It is a tough race, especially when you think about what we've been through. We've had four very hard stages in the mountains, and I think there's a lot of riders tired in this Tour de France, and they will be very happy once they get up to the finish line on the Champs-Élysées, which makes me wonder whether or not Andy Schleck has got something up his sleeve for the individual time trial. If you look at the statistics, if you look at the history, Andy Schleck certainly should get beaten hands down by Alberto Contador. But every time we talk to him, Phil, at the finish of the stages, he just seems so relaxed and confident. Even last night, he didn't sound like a man who was giving up.
No, he isn't. I've just got a sneaking feeling he's going to surprise us in this time trial. I really have. There's no reason to say that other than the way he is. He's very confident, and he's made a lot of friends in this last 3 weeks of the Tour de France as well.
But the question about today is really all about the sprint, and Bordeaux in its past has really been an area of the sprinters. It's been the domain of the sprinters, with all of the big names actually winning here, including, of course, the great British sprinter Barry Hoban, who won here on two occasions back in 1975. But then you add the other names, great sprinting names like Urs Freuler, Jan Raas, Davis Finney of the United States, Jean-Paul Van Poppel. They really are seriously all big sprinters, and they all really want to win here. And this, I think, today is an ideal finish for the sprinters, Phil, because it's a 3 kilometre straight all the way along the side of the Garonne. But as you mentioned, the big danger for the sprinters is the headwind. And if you start the sprint too early, you will get defeated.
That's it. It's all about judging to perfection. And Tor Hushovd is a man with the strength of a mature cyclist now. He's not just a pure sprinter. Reminds me of Sean Kelly in many, many ways. Sean was a brilliant sprinter, although he only won 5 stages of the Tour de France. I think he had 15 second places. Eddie Merckx used to tell us he sold those because he never kept winning when he should be winning. But I can guarantee he didn't. Just never had the chance to just get over the line in first place.
Well, you can see now that the work being done at the front end of the main field is having the right job. These are great roads for cycling on, especially if you're the kind of cyclist that I was, because they are pan flat. And when you ride through this forested part, despite the fact there is quite a heavy wind coming in off the Atlantic Ocean, it doesn't get into this part of the Les Landes. It's fairly protected, and I think everybody will be happy about that, because if these had been open roads, I think we'd have had a serious ripping apart of the main field. As we look here, that's Daniel Oss in the lime green there for Liquigas. Jérôme Pinot on the far side, the early leader of the King of the Mountains classification in that big long breakaway on the road into Spa. Now, how long ago did that seem? Matty Breschel at the back, formerly the national champion of his country, and Benoît Voronard just on the far side, Frenchman from Française-des-Jeux. Right into the heart of Les Landes. It's a long stage like this. Tomorrow is a very important individual time trial. Then the riders will make the transfer up overnight by the high-speed train, the TGV, to Longjumeau for the start of the final stage of the day.
So as we look at the riders going away today, if I was the sprinter Alessandro Petacchi, or maybe Mark Cavendish, they're going to go head-to-head.
I think they're all going to go head-to-head. The thing, I think that Tor Hushovd, he's really on the defensive because he knows that these guys are breathing down his neck in a sprint situation like this, and he will do his very best. But as he said, I think earlier on to us, Phil, he feels better as he comes out of the mountains, and he's a very strong bike rider. He knows how to recover, and it's all going to be about the rider who is the freshest at the end of those four big Pyrenean stages.
We're going to find out very, very soon, about 67 kilometres time.
Yep, 67 kilometres at speeds like this is just around about the 90 minutes mark. There is Mark, as I said, Cavendish on this occasion, number 111. He's dragged his body through the mountains, and he was escorted every time he got dropped. Bernie Eisel, the Austrian rider on HTC Columbia, stopped with him, paced him through the mountains, talked him through the mountains, paced him back into the main field, and that was an important thing for the sprinters because it's so easy for a sprinter to get demoralized when you get left behind. It's all to do with the physiology. A sprinter has fast twist muscles. To put it into track and field, for example, you're talking about the difference between a guy who can run 100 meters and a guy who can run the 3,000 meter steeplechase. Completely different kind of bike rider.
Well, there is the there's the crop in 5 or 6 years' time, just beneath camera here. The background is probably going to be chopped down next year, but this is a very fertile region. But you won't get any flatter than this. Are you sure we haven't gone back to Rotterdam, Paul? We're not racing across Holland.
Well, there'd be a lot more water if it was Holland, but it's just definitely a similar kind of profile.
Okay, completely pan flat. You've got all the water you want, the Atlantic Ocean.
Yep, and the big holiday beaches of the southern part of France as well, and certainly this is the flattest stage that we have had, I think, Phil, probably since the stage through Holland. And everybody turning out to enjoy themselves. I think it looks a little bit like Tom Cruise at the side of the road there with Cameron Diaz. Obviously some VIP guests on the tour.
Well, they did promise to come and see us, but maybe they won't bother. Steady, honey, steady. Tour de France hasn't finished yet. So they're coming up towards the finish. They'll be up in time to see the arrival of the Tour de France, I'm sure, because they've still got 66 kilometres to go. They might even let them go past the riders, you know.
You never know. They may well have permission to do a lot of things this afternoon.
Well, lovely scenery nonetheless. I said it before, I know, but it is such a diverse country, France. We've gone from those beautiful mountains of yesterday. Well, they weren't so pleasant, I must say, but they're still beautiful in the weather that we had yesterday. That's now behind the riders, literally. If you turn around on this road, you'd actually would go into Spain via Biarritz and into San Sebastian and deep into the Spanish country. And it is very close to just about anywhere, it seems, France.
No, it certainly is the center of Europe, and it is as far as they're concerned. And they have, as you said, such a great diverse culture and a diverse agricultural land as well. Everything that France has to offer, which is not a really major surprise, Phil, as to why the French don't really travel that much overseas, because they've got everything they want in the backyard.
They're getting invaded by the rest of Europe at this time of the year, because once the Tour de France is on, it has gained popularity all over the world. We have met today, for example, a lot of spectators from South Africa, from Australia, and indeed from the United States, and from Great Britain. And the Norwegians are here. I don't know why this year they've chosen this year, but Tor Hosch has told us earlier that he's being mobbed for his autograph every day. And when we look out of our commentary box window, it's predominantly the Norwegian flag that he's flying.
Well, bear in mind, it's not just Tor Hushovde. The Norwegian history with cycling goes back to the times of Dag Otto Lauritzen, who laid the foundations for a great Norwegian interest in the sport. Then you have Tor Hushovde. But, of course, let's not forget they've got a youngster on the way up, Edwell Bosenhagen, yep, who's going to be a great star for them.
And he's on Team Sky.
So the four men in the breakaway, they just they're going to wait until they feel the main field starting to pick up its pace closer down towards the end. We're looking here, this is a good study of Matty Breschel. Breschel, one of the riders who thought he was going to win Paris-Roubaix this year, but he had to take second row to his own teammate, and that, of course, was Fabian Cancellara. He's a young guy, he's just 25 years of age, but he's already won 15 races. He's been the national road race champion of Denmark. Has been a professional since 2004, but this year he did win the very important race in Belgium, the Dwar door Vlaanderen, which means the race across Flanders, and it is a very tough race indeed, almost like a mini Tour of Flanders. There we get a chance to see, and there is Cameron Diaz, a ringside seat for her. I hope she's enjoying the Tour de France here this afternoon and getting the very big VIP special treatment out on the roads of Lelande. Nice seat in the house there for Cameron Diaz, right behind the breakaway on a day like this. This is a great chance to actually get in and see the race as it develops.
Well, 2:09 is the gap now, 61 kilometres still to ride. The peloton have dangled behind at this distance now for kilometre after kilometre. When will they chase it down, Paul?
Well, the most important thing is to pull it back at around about 15 to 20 kilometres. That's the optimum moment when you can pull back a breakaway of four riders. But to do that at 2 minutes advantage, I would think in the next 10 or 15 kilometres, they need to start reducing that 2 minutes down to a minute and then try and pull it back in at about 20 kilometres to go.
And if they do, we've seen a lot of the evidence of Lamprey chasing and one or two of HTC. They're reduced, of course, without Mark Renshaw. But, you know, at the start this morning, Cavendish did sound as though he really was quite ill. Apparently he's got a bit of bronchitis.
Yeah, well, you know, the sprinters are a very strange breed, and even if he's not feeling too good, he will do whatever he can on the running towards the finish. But bear in mind, there's another team that could come up towards the front end on the running towards the finish as well, Team Milram, as we were talking about this morning, Phil. Those guys are looking for a sponsor. They got a very good sprinter in their midst, and that, of course, is Gerard Cholik.
It's a big chance for Gerard now, because we've lost one or two of the big sprinters. Sadly, Robbie Hunter went, and also Tyler Farrar, and indeed Mark Renshaw, the big fast lead out man for Mark Cavendish. So there's one or two guys that are going to think they've got a chance now. Let's have a look at this chateau anyway.
Well, we're quite lucky because we're mainly driving through the forested part of Lelande, and there's not a great deal of chateaus, but there is one here. This is the chateau of Rochefort-la-Vie, and it, in fact, is situated on an old feudal fort, which was originally a medieval castle, was restored and built back up in the 18th century.
Looks as though they've done a pretty nice job, get the name and address of the renovators, as they worked hard on that one, as the race continues on at 2:15, the gap now.
2:15, it's yo-yoing back and forth. Well, I think Tom Cruise is having a whole lot of fun here this afternoon. Probably here, I would think, to promote his new film, along with Cameron Diaz. They're having a great time. They're right in front of the main field, and I wonder what the riders think about that. I do remember when I raced in the Tour de France in the 80s, Dustin Hoffman was a guest on the tour for a couple of days, and he came down because at the time he actually wanted to make a movie called The Yellow Jersey. And they spent a lot of money filming the background footage for that, and all of a sudden it never happened because the funding was never finalized. And what they decided to do was put it all into the archive, so it's all sitting there somewhere. Chris Horner here, best-placed American overall. He overtook his teammate yesterday, Levi Leipheimer, and crumbled on the final couple of stages in the Pyrenees, but Chris Horner didn't. And at 38 years of age, he climbed up the overall standings yesterday to just get inside of the top 10. On the far side is the American time trial champion, Dave Zabriskie. There's the world champion. Just talking about him a few moments ago, 1:21, Cadel Evans, the first time ever an Australian has been a world road racing champion, and a title which he'll get a chance to defend almost on home turf, really, when the championships happen right at the end of the year in September between Melbourne and Geelong. The race actually starting in Melbourne and then finishing on a circuit in the city of Geelong. Somebody's looked as if he was going for it this afternoon. You see the big, deep carbon fiber rims on a couple of the riders there. These are the kind of rims, Phil, you can only really use on a real flat stage like this, a flat stage where you expect the roads to be good, because they actually are very hard ride. And this guy obviously felt that he was looking for the breakaway this afternoon, which is why he's got those special wheels on.
Probably was nicked down to the mechanic last night and said, put them wheels on for me today, I'm going tomorrow. Well, the roads are the good, they are actually extremely good, well-surfaced roads in this region. I don't think they've done them just for the Tour de France, but that itself is often the case. But today's route has been basically flat from start to finish. That's the recent outcrop of trees that have gone to the wood factory, while these boys are now making their way up towards the finish in Bordeaux. Matty Breschel, he wanted to be in the Tour de France this year. Saxo Bank gave him their chance, and he's made it, and he's ridden extremely well. Daniel Oss, the same, the youngster on leaky gas, experienced his first tour. And going to the finish as well, which is the big thing in your first tour, because it's true, isn't it, Paul? Once you do complete a Tour de France, you become a different bike rider.
No, certainly, and many times I've talked to the doctor from Team BMC, Massimo Testa, who's been a doctor for many years in the sport of professional cycling, now actually practicing in the United States with Eric Heiden. And he always said that the third week of a Grand Tour actually physiologically changes you for the rest of your life. And it's something in that third week that you cannot acquire from actually training. You have to do a Grand Tour to get that latent strength which you build up.
Yep.
So talking about latent strength, this man certainly has that. He's been to the Tour de France many times. Big Tour Hushovd is a defending champion in the green jersey points classification. He had a very quiet year this year because, in fact, he didn't have a victory at all until he won the National Road Racing Championships in June. He had expected to ride the Amgen Tour of California in May instead of riding the Giro d'Italia, and he crashed while out training and broke his collarbone. And rather embarrassing, but it put him behind in his preparation, and he only just started to get back into form during the Tour of Switzerland, which happened just before the start of this race. And now he's looking to see whether or not he can take that green jersey all the way up to Paris, and that is basically his major goal over the next couple of days. He needs to keep a very close eye on two riders. The two riders closest to him are Alessandro Petacchi from Italy and Team Lampre, and of course the British rider Mark Cavendish. He's won eight stages throughout his career at the Tour, and one of those was recently this year. Well, we get a chance to see the stars here this afternoon. We're moving up and down the VIP cars to have a look at Cameron Diaz there. And in one of the other cars, just a little while back, we saw Tom Cruise. So the big names are visiting the Tour de France on what is a magical day to visit it, because I'm sure they'll be staying in one of the local chateaus this afternoon. And some of the great chateaus are just beyond the finish line. This really is, as we move into the heart of the Bordeaux region, this is, I would have to say, the capital of the wine-growing area. Even many of the vines that are cultivated in South Africa, or California, or in many other places around the world, originated from the Bordeaux region of France. So Hushovd riding his tour for the 10th time. Those are the VIP cars in front. Those are funny little balloons on the top, are an omnidirectional antenna which allows them to pick up satellite television. So when they're not actually so close to the actual riders, they can actually see a very good image of the race on television, watching exactly the same television images as we are. There's Damiana Cunego. Just looking a little bit further back, there's a piece of traffic furniture in the middle of the road here, and the policeman making sure that everybody splits off. That's Carlos Sastre just going by, and just at the back end of the pack there, Geraint Thomas, the British national champion. So Maxime Montfort now comes to the front, and in fact, that leading group obviously have realised that as we get closer to the more important part of the race, they have to pick up the pacemaking. They've picked up the pacemaking in the front to match the pace rise in the main field. So you've just noticed that gap has all of a sudden once again raised itself to fairly close to 2¾ minutes. Astana, they're not concerned at all there. The riders in the turquoise jersey, they're protecting their man in the yellow there, and that, of course, is Alberto Contador. Leads this race by the slimmest of margins, a mere 8 seconds. And that's not the closest difference between two big leaders on the eve of the very important individual time trial. That goes back to 1990, when Greg LeMond was separated by Claudio Chiappucci by a mere 5 seconds although Greg LeMond on that occasion was 5 seconds behind the Italian and had to beat him in the individual time trial to win the Tour that year. He wasn't confident he could do it, but he did by over a minute. Spanish national champion in the red and yellow jersey there. He rides for Case de Pana, and that, of course, Jose Ivan Gutierrez, better known as a time trial champion of his own country. This year, he was beaten by his teammate, Luis Leon Sanchez. We're not too far an hour away from leaving the department of Les Landes, and once we leave that department behind us, we will move into the Gironde. And the Gironde is an extremely important part of France. 95 different metropolitan departments, including 4 overseas departments as well. And this one is pretty much the most important part of this area. The capital, of course, is Bordeaux. It belongs to a region which they call the Aquitaine. Quick look at Armstrong there. Obviously, decided wasn't too keen on having the radio in this afternoon. Lots of chatting. You see, there's no pressure on the main field at the moment. I think they've got themselves pretty much locked in place, as they know just exactly what sort of effort they need to do. HTC Colombia is an extremely well-drilled squad. They've won over 300 races since they were formed about 2.5 years ago on the international circuit for men, but also they have a very successful women's racing program, and they are extremely dominant there as well.
These four ride on with the hope that the peloton forget about them. That's an impossible hope, I suspect. Matty Breschler in the black, and Jerome Pinot, seen it all before. He's been in breaks a number of times, at the back of the break right now in this year's Tour de France. 9 days he spent in the King of the Mountains jersey, and he wasn't able to take the final one home. The other Frenchman, Anthony Charteau, has done that.
But they're still keeping it pretty well stretched out, and looking at the way the HTC Colombia riders were chatting at the front end of the main field, Phil, the chase is not yet on in earnest. The two men who finished first and second overall in the Tour de France, Armstrong on the inside in the Radio Shack colours, and Ivan Basso, who finished second to him.
Two old friends, actually. They consolidated their friendship in the heyday of the Tour de France, when Lance was winning and Basso was finishing second or third. That's where they made their friendship, and sadly, when Ivan's mum died of cancer, Lance was there as a friend and gave him a lot of helpful encouragement and advice at that time.
Basso certainly hasn't enjoyed this tour. In fact, he's suffering from bronchitis a fraction, and he actually experienced something in the Pyrenees, Phil, that I'm sure he's probably never experienced before. He finished in what we call the gruppetto, or the autobus, the group that contains all of the sprinters and non-climbers, losing himself 38 minutes on one stage.
Team Milram cruising near the front. They're beginning, Luke Roberts having a nice smile there, into the Département de la Gironde. That's the big river here now, so the boys will know they're getting closer to Bordeaux, because that's the department of Bordeaux. It's the big river that feeds out into the Atlantic here. 3 hours, 29 minutes they've been riding the bike now, and they've got 53 kilometres still to go. The road's almost straight all of the way, and that's another disadvantage, of course, for the breakaway, because a sped of 2.5 minutes is only about, 1.5 kilometres?
Well, maximum 2 kilometres at this average speed. We would look at the riders on the running towards the finish probably covering a kilometre in just over 1 minute. But here we're looking at about 40 kilometres now. So you're looking at around about a minute 15 to a minute 20 per kilometre. As we're actually going the wrong way at the moment. I'm not sure if the helicopter pilot's lost, but he's obviously decided that he wants to give us an idea of a view of how big the convoy is behind the main field.
So Mark Cavendish stalking here. Yes, keep on whipped up, Mark, because the finish is what you are like. It's not far to go now. Looking at the peloton, the echelon forming at the front, the workhorses taking the riders into the wind. But if you can't have the strength to get to the front, life at the back is not so good. A long straight line at the moment. I'm just wondering what's happening there. I think Andy might not be feeling too good. I think he wants a settling stomach tablet here, or has he got something wrong with his hand?
Well, I'm not sure what it is, but in fact, just a few moments ago, the gestures that he was making, I think, was he wanted a little bit of privacy when he was talking to the doctor, and I'm not surprised, really. I think we all want to go to our consultations with the doctors and have some privacy. But yes, he was there for a long time, so the big question marks are, was there a serious problem, or is there a serious problem?
Yeah. Well, Gerhard Port is the boy. He is the most experienced doctor on the Tour de France. He's been here. Well, in all honesty, he can't be far off his 40th Tour de France.
Well, Phil, I know. I was in the Tour de France 32 years ago, and Gerhard Port was there then, and he picked me up a number of times.
Yeah. Was that because you were tired or had you fallen off?
He picked me up. I had a few nasty crashes, and you remember because you bought me a bottle of champagne once for finishing the stage, and you thought I was quite brave.
Yes, you kept the romanticisms of the Tour going by fighting on to the finish, having fallen off in the first kilometre of the day. A very lonely ride, like David Miller, in fact, did this year.
So we're not too...
Did we go through that sprint?
Well, we're just looking at the...
Heading to it. I think we're just heading to it.
The final sprint point of the day at the town over Hostens, 150 kilometres covered. And once again, the 4 points being taken away, the 3 points being taken away for the first three riders to cross the line. So again, advantage tipping over towards Tor Hushov. There's the banner just in the distance.
Yeah, this is exactly what Hushov wants. Take all the points and throw them away as far as he's concerned. He's back in the main field. And it's Daniel Oss. Doesn't exactly win the sprint, does he?
No, but they've got to keep their wits about them, keep themselves organised. Jérôme Pinot will probably be the man who is keeping this coordinated. Oss, Pinot and Breschel were the first three riders to cross the line there. And we're not too sure still what the situation is with Andy Schleck as he was consulting the race doctor, Dr. Gerhard Port. Big crowd. This is a big holiday part of France here, and there are lots of holiday camps for kids that kids come down and stay for a couple of weeks as we go through Hostens, but the majority of the holiday making area is around about 15 kilometers away from here. To take any of these roads off to the left hand side and very quickly you'll be on the Atlantic Ocean. But the job is being done in the main field, and this is being done by again a very drilled squad here, and now we're getting a third team starting to come up, and that would be the indication that Milram are keen to make sure that this breakaway doesn't survive. And I wonder if a little later on we may well see the approach to the front end of the main field of the men in orange there, because although they're looking at keeping their man Denny Menchoff in fourth place overall, there is also the possibility that their man Oscar Ferreira, three times champion of the world, could be thinking about his chance of getting a stage victory. They haven't had too much success, Rabobank, although they are at the moment currently looking at trying to get a man onto the finishing podium. They've been meandering along quite rapidly in the front end of the main field, and you can see that line of riders at the front. Those are the guys doing the pacemaking. The bulk of the riders behind, for probably 50% of that main field, those riders are all trying to find a place where they can shelter from the wind, because despite the fact that we're in this very forested area of this part of France, there is quite a wind coming in off the Atlantic Ocean this afternoon. The Atlantic Ocean is not very much more than 15 to 20 kilometers away from us on the left-hand side of the riders. Well, we're looking at 2:22 now as it starts to come down, and they, I think, now will start to take a much more serious look and a much more serious attitude in starting to bring that group all back together, because they want to have them at around about a minute when they get to something like 30 kilometres to go.
OK, Paul, the Église at Saint-Pierre, Church.
Church of Saint-Pierre in the town of Hostens. It was actually destroyed in 1860, and all that remained was the façade, and it was rebuilt and modernised in the 20th century in a neo-gothical style. And not too far away from the church, in fact, there's a rather interesting leisure centre which has five lakes offering many different activities.
Well, a very pretty picture. It looks like a model village from the helicopters. The Tour de France streams through in a big peloton today. 171 riders started this morning, still surviving. Four are up front. As far as we know, no one has been left behind today. They're all happy to be in that big peloton. I know it looks easy, and the way we contact, we sound a little bit flippant sometimes. It is really hard down there. For many riders now who've been suffering for the last few days, they really just want to get to Bordeaux and have a rest.
I think they want to get to Paris and have a day off on Monday. That's the thing in the back of a lot of these riders' minds. But I am amazed this year, and we've done the Tour de France for many years together, 32 years for me, 38 for you. But I'm quite amazed, Phil, at how quickly this year's Tour de France seems to have gone by.
It has. There's been so much to talk about. That's why it's been very exciting, I felt. And I must confess, after all those years, it's a lifetime, let's face it. I just don't get tired of doing the the commentary on the tour. And being a bird watcher, we're in a very nice part of the world. This is a migratory tract now down the west coast of France.
No, it certainly is, and this is a big tourist complex. This is the area I was telling you about just a few moments ago, and in the forest around here you can trek, you can horse ride, there's mountain bike paths, and of course if you're into canoe kayak, you've just got a very good sight to see that you can take a canoe around this part of the world, quietly out into the middle of the lake and check out the bird life.
2 minutes, 12 seconds as we watch here the race. Just had a little note passed to us, Paul. Tom Cruise would like to come and sit with us. What do you reckon?
Well, no problem at all. I'll leave and he can have my chair.
You stay right where you are. I may have a problem pointing out the riders to Tom. Anyway, these four boys, the sun is now settling. This is the Bordeaux that we know because we had rain here in Bordeaux this morning. Now, all the memories since back to 1973 when I first came to Bordeaux, I can only remember absolutely scorching hot conditions. It's not that today,
no,
but the sun is at least coming out.
It's all to do, I think, with that big massive storm we had in the Pyrenees. I think that brought the temperatures down dramatically, Phil, from the 30 degrees Celsius which we had through the whole of the Pyrenees down to what is basically today a very comfortable 20 degrees Celsius.
Well, these boys still go on.
So, Jérôme Pinault and Matty Breschel, number 12, he's getting himself sorted out at the front end of the main field, but as you can see, that gap now is starting to come downwards, and I have a feeling that once we get to the 30 kilometer to go point, that's when they're going to want to see that time gap at around about the 1 minute mark, and then they will slowly but surely bring themselves a little closer. And the thing that makes me think that we're going to see a doomed breakaway attempt today is we've got another team coming to the front. There are allies for team HTC Colombia on this occasion. In the first part of the tour, it was very much just HTC Colombia until Alessandro Petacchi started winning stages. And then he decided his team, first of all, would become their ally. And now, in the latter part of the race, with Team Milram looking for a stage victory, they've sent a couple of riders up as well to keep the pace nice and high. So, three teams at the front. It's Milram, Lamprey and HTC Colombia. We are, I think, getting ourselves set up to what is going to be a very dramatic sprint to the line.
The arrival of Milram at the front now. Two riders, Paul. It looks as though Gerald Joic is thinking of winning the stage as well.
Well, there in the fluorescent green bike there, just in front of us in the middle of the picture, there is Alessandro Petacchi. He, I think, will be feeling very confident. This is a magnificent sprint field to the line here in Bordeaux, alongside the Garonne River, not too far away from Bordeaux-Lillac. They hit the riverside at 4 kilometres to go, and basically there is hardly a kink in the road all the way up to the finish line. You cannot get, I don't think, a better sprint finish for the sprinters, but the big difficulty is that big raising headwind, and if you get it wrong, if you lead out too early and fade, there'll be certainly somebody sitting in your slipstream to take that win away from you.
Yes, perfection is going to be a great sprint, there's no question that's going to live in the tradition of Bordeaux. We used to finish on the old velodrome here till the mid-70s, and that was where the great British sprinter Barry Hogan used to take everybody to task and beat them on the track. And the other man who always won there was the brilliant French sprinter André Darrigard. But we won't be finishing on the velodrome now. It'll be straight down what we call the quays here, alongside the banks of the rivers you're on. That's still to come, and they've still got to catch these four riders, by the way. France, as the riders now are continuing to negotiate, this is the Memorial de la Ferme de Richemont that we're looking at here at the moment, as the riders now will shortly pass by it. I think you can see from the trees behind it just how strong the wind is.
Yeah, this in fact is built to the memory of 12 young people, students between 17 and 22 years of age, Phil, who were wiped out on the 14th of July 1944 by the militia of the Vichy government. And it, as you can see, it is a rather an important memorial in this part of the world.
That's that, Paul. 2 minutes just over now for the four riders. They are still hovering. They've been down to 157. They've shot out to 2.5. They're going absolutely nowhere here. And they're picking up a tail to crosswind. It's a westerly wind coming off the Atlantic. It'll be right on the noses as they sprint down for the finishing line in Bordeaux. can be a difficult sprint to judge, and as always on this part of the world, there are super crowds all the way along the area of the Gironde.
But as you can see in the main field, they've actually picked up the pace making. There are three teams, and that makes around about 15 riders, maybe 16, 17 riders setting the pace making. But this group now has also lifted up their pace. They've been conserving a bit of energy because they know it's the final 40 kilometers when the pace starts to be lifted in the main field, and they're hoping now that they can match it. Matty Breschel may well be able to match it. He's a very talented rider there, number 12. He won the race across Belgium in the early part of this year, a very important one-day classic. The other rider, Daniel Oss from the Liquigas team, he's much more renowned as a track rider, and now he's decided to make the jump across to the road riding section of the sport. Pino, he is experienced. He's ridden the Tour de France so many times. He's had the lead this year in the King of the Mountains classification in that very long breakaway with his own teammate, and that was Sylvain Chavanel on the road down into Po. And in this tour, he's participating in the Tour de France for his ninth occasion. And that's him on the front there with the blue jersey of Team Quickstep. Oss, first Tour de France for him, part of a team which has been extremely successful throughout the whole of the international season, although they haven't got what they wanted so far out of the Tour de France. And at 36 kilometres, it's locked at 2 minutes.
Peloton being driven on, Paul, by the same boys, Milram, Lamprey and HTC Columbia. They all believe they have the winner and the man that's going to pick up €8,000 at the end of the day. This is the village of Villagrand.
Well, despite the fact, Phil, that there's a number of teams doing the pacemaking at the front, they're not eating as quickly into that advantage as I would have expected them to, but I still don't think they've got the organised chase on in full bore.
I think they're just leaving them out there. I think you're probably right. It'll be between 10 and 5 kilometres to go is when I think they'll try to bring them all down. Then you'll see a very different peloton. With the sort of wind that's blowing, they're going to hit over 50, 55 kilometres an hour when they finally decide to go.
Yeah, but the closer they get to Bordeaux as well, the less the wind is going to be important as a factor, because they'll start to get into the more built-up part of the world. I keep looking at the Union Jacks at the side of the road, and I just hope they've got them the right way up.
I didn't check, actually. Very naughty of me, that, yes. Very difficult to know. As you see now, Lamprey again. Some of the boys here very concentrated today. No hills in prospect, of course. Must be a great relief. Nicky Sorensen on the far left of our picture there.
One rider who could be important on the run-in towards the finish, Phil, for Alessandro Patacchi is Damiano Cunego, who actually, I thought, rode fairly well through a couple of the Pyrenean stages. He was itching to get himself a stage victory, and he rode pretty well on some of the big breakaways.
Cunego has never really enjoyed his Tour de France. He has won the white jersey in the Tour. He is a winner of the Tour of Italy in the past, but he just only goes for days in the Tour. He's not quite the rider he is when he's back home in his own country, but you're right, he had a few good digs in the Pyrenees, almost pulled off on one occasion. Looking at 212 at the moment, it looks a very small peloton down there. We just heard about the abandon of Reda in his first Tour de France. 2 days from the finish in Paris, and he's had to pull out of the Tour. Really bad luck. Happened to Sean Yates once the day before, didn't it?
The day before. Sean Yates actually abandoned on the Saturday before the Tour finished on the Sunday. Now, that I was very saddened about, because Sean Yates has always been a very good mate of mine, one of the team managers for Team Sky. But just looking there briefly at Maxime Molfort on the front end of the main field, he is now starting to lift the game here in the main field. And you can see a lot of those teams of the sprinters are getting themselves together, but never far from the front end of the main field are the turquoise jerseys of Team Astana, and that, of course, is the team of Alberto Contador. The reason they're riding at the front end, they're not interested about the sprint on the road into Bordeaux here this afternoon, Phil. For them, the most important thing is to make sure they keep Alberto Contador at the front end of the pack to make sure there isn't a split. Because, you know, a run into the finish and a split in the main field in the sprint can very easily create a 5, 8 or 10 minute gap, 10 second gap, and that could see the racer lead change because of a split in the main field.
You've got to be very careful. That abandonment of Sean Yates, by the way, was stage 13 in 1995, all those years ago.
Daniel Oss, he's just stamping out. You know, these guys, Phil, they've got the tempo pegged with the main field, but at the moment the main field's tempo is not being done by a group of riders. It's being done by one rider from each team who's riding for a good kilometre or so, then swinging off, then allowing somebody else. As they get closer to the finish, they will start to increase the number of turns that they do.
Well, as we're watching here, Team Sky, as you know, in their first Tour de France. Good news reaching my ears at the moment, because their Australian youngster, Chris Sutton, has just won the Brixia Tour, which is a big feather in his cap, and I'm quite sure that next year Sutton will be in the Tour de France. He's an Australian. His dad, Gary, by the way, was a world champion on the track, and he's now making good progress as a young pro himself.
Yeah, well, a great chateau we're looking down at here. Look at that moat all the way around it. This castle was built in the Gothic style around about the 14th century. And as you can see, it's surrounded by those moats. But the reason it was made there was really, and it was built to try and look like an English-style park in the outskirts of Bordeaux.
Well, that's beautiful, that. It's the only property where you can fish out of every window. I like that.
And I'm sure you'll find some extremely large carp in that moat.
I'm sure. And there's even some people down there who are not watching the Tour de France today. I can't believe that bit. I'm sure they'll be rushing to the fence when we come up. That really is a magnificent building.
No, quite phenomenal.
Anyway, as we continue to spin around France at the moment, I'm just looking at the computer at the moment, and this is the one where even the computer is quite often wrong, but it has been right too. But he's actually saying the catch will be made at 5 kilometres to go. I remember on one occasion in the first 2 weeks of the tour, it predicted it exactly right, 1 kilometre to go, and they did the catch. But it's been wrong on other occasions, though.
The only problem is what the computer doesn't fathom out is how the riders behind actually slow and speed up their pace.
That's right.
To catch them at the time they want to.
Yeah, that's absolutely right.
So we're looking at 2 minutes, so we're looking at a very, very nice piece of machinery here that Daniel Oss, number 46 of Liquigas, is riding. That's an American bike, by the way, Cannondale, just from outside of Stamford, Connecticut, around about 20 kilometres up to the north. So Benoît Vironat, all of these riders still pretty much sharing the pacemaking, and all of a sudden now, Phil, we're starting to get a slightly bigger chase, a more concerted effort, because Tony Martin on the front end, we've seen him doing a fair amount of work. He's actually been pushing it up to 48 kilometres an hour, and most of the time he's been pushing his wattage above 300 watts.
Wow.
That's three light bulbs.
Say to that.
Well, it was three light bulbs. We use energy-saving light bulbs nowadays.
Cheaper to take Tony home and power the house with him. 2 minutes and 3 seconds. We're inside 20 miles or 31.7 kilometres left to ride here now, but you can see when you get these helicopter shots how quick we are. There's the old road again. It is dead straight. It goes right into infinity today. That's the area we are in now, and off the side of these roads are some beautiful cycling lanes as well, with lovely villages. But today it's all about whether Marc Cavendish can win his 14th historical stage of the Tour de France and his fourth this year. He's relying on his team to do it right now, and he might yet do it. ...90 seconds is all that remains now. Suddenly they're beginning to chase, and this is the target, Bordeaux, as the bridge over the Gironde here. It filters out into the Atlantic Ocean. It's at its widest here as it goes off into the ocean or the sea. And this is the famous Garonne we're looking at the moment. The two rivers filter out of Bordeaux into the Atlantic.
Yeah, the two rivers here, the Garonne and the Gironde, actually run parallel in this part of the world, but certainly at the end of the Garonne where we are sitting, just over, if we could just look across, we can see the Garonne River, which goes out into the North Atlantic. And these guys at the moment are heading down in that direction. A lot of urgency now, Phil, starting to appear at the front end of the main field, and that's because these guys want to see that leading group of four brought back into the fold.
You see by the speed of the peloton, it's a westerly wind, the road is zigzagging a little bit, they're picking up cross to tail, and because of that, the pace has shot up now. The last time we saw a speedometer on the motorbike, they were doing 60 kilometres an hour, and the gap is coming down, a minute 24.
Yep, it is now starting to come down quite quickly. It has never really been given that much of an advantage. Those four riders got themselves a maximum lead of 3 minutes and 40 seconds. But the sprinters in the Tour de France this year have not had that many opportunities, which is why they've completely controlled these kind of stages, where they felt that they have a chance of showing why they're known as the warriors of the route on the run in towards the finish. And they've controlled these races to absolute perfection. A lot more urgency, though, now, because Lampre, you can see the difference in the style of the riders. Before, they were riding a tempo on the front end of the main field. Now, all of a sudden, this is the start of the chase. This is not the chase proper. This is not the big organized chase. It's still individual riders from the individual teams keeping the pace nice and high. But when you look at the back end of the main field, you get much more of an idea of just how fast this main field is getting dragged along. I would not want to be sitting there right now.
Oh, dear me, it's a bit painful at the back. Look at the gaps between the wheels. That's when you know it's hurting. If you're going good, you're right up against that back wheel, making the most of it. If you like the chap on the right there, trying to catch the back wheel in front, you're under pressure.
Well, the word that we use in professional cycling to describe that, it's gutter grovelling, and there was a lot of gutter grovelling going on at the back. It doesn't look quite so hard at the front, which is why I always say the best place to ride in the main field is in the first 40 positions in the main field, because at the back you've got that very, very difficult position of never having any shelter from the wind.
25 kilometres to go, and the gap, we'll see when they get there, but that's for the leaders.
Yep, Mark Cavendish sitting in the main field. He's got to pay back his teammates this afternoon. But I wonder, Alessandro Pataki's team seems to be doing a lot more of the pacemaking. There's Chris Horner, number 23, climbed up to 10th place in the overall standings, which is not that bad at all at 38 years of age.
Well, as the cameras zoom along here, the Garonne, there are two rivers here. This is the wider one, the Garonne, a bit more industry on that river. And the beautiful meandering Gironde. Minute 12, the gap at the moment, the chase is on now. How long will they survive, or will they want to catch them before, as the computer tells us, 5 kilometres to go?
Well, the speed that they are going right now, I would think we could see that catch being between 10 and 12 kilometres to go to the finish. And once they've got themselves flying like this, they're not going to turn off. They want to keep the pressure on, they keep the momentum going, and they won't concern themselves as to whether it's 5 or 10 kilometres to go. What they want to do now is get the job done.
There's the banner for the boys as they've gone up at about a minute 9, a minute 10 is the gap at 25 kilometres to go. This is HTC Colombia working very, very hard. Their job is simply to get the race all together, and then they'll start changing partners to decide on how they're going to guide Cavendish to the finish. He's lost his pilot fish in Mark Renshaw, Paul. It's going to be a different sprint for Mark.
Well, it will. He'll have to look after himself on his own. But don't ever forget about Mark Cavendish, Phil. He came from a background on the track. He knows how to sprint. He knows how to sprint on his own. Yes, he's developed a very good technique with Mark Renshaw, but he still knows how to win a race when he has to on his own.
Yeah.
Well, there's a problem. I'm hearing this over race radio. In fact, at this speed, Luis Leon Sanchez, there it is. He's had a problem. No panic at all for him, except for the fact the main field is charging along at 50 kilometres an hour. You see how he took that wheel out, threw it to the side of the road, mechanic will pick it up, and then he'll get pushed off, and he's back into the main field. He'll use the cars as quickly as possible. I'd expected a high finish from Luis Leon Sanchez in the overall standings, but over the last couple of days in the mountains, he did suffer a fraction. He's still just outside the top 10 in 11th place and looking for 12 minutes and 46 seconds. A great ride in the individual time trial, of which he is the Spanish champion, could put him inside of the top 10. The gap's now down to that 1 minute 60 seconds. And on these very long roads here through the flatter part of France, just outside of Bordeaux, they will be able to see their prey, the men that they've been looking after, looking forward to catching over the last 2 hours of the race. And there they are. They've got a couple of team cars behind them. The yellow car is the neutral service vehicle. And I can see the race referee is getting himself organized, getting ready to pull that back into the fold. As soon as he starts to feel that they're going to get caught, he will stop the team cars behind and only leave one car, and that car will eventually get pulled out at 30 seconds.
The four riders out in front. Let's just have a look. What does the computer say there, Paul? He's now... Oh, it's chickening out the computer now, isn't it? It's moved it out to 11 kilometres to go for the catch.
Well, it's not the computer that decides where the catch is going to be made, Phil. It's the riders in the main field who decide. And all of a sudden, I think once they saw the job that they were doing, they said, right, we'll keep the hammer down now, we'll keep the momentum going. When you look at the face of Maxime Montfort here on the front, you know they want to get it over and done with. And when you look at the average speed, we're looking at 31 miles an hour, 50 kilometres an hour for the peloton. This hurts. The best place to be is to sit at the front end of the main field, because there are a lot of guys right now at the back who are really struggling.
So the Belgian at the back, now just coming through the cars here, 161 is Luis Leon Sanchez. He's just had a flat tyre, and the car Radio Shack has instantly moved him into the position, which is good because Radio Shack and this team, Case de Pon, have been locked together in a three-week battle for the team prize. And Radio Shack have moved into a clear lead in the last 2 days. Nonetheless, all's fair in love and war as Leon Sanchez now makes his way up to the field. Field is almost all together too. 57 seconds to the catch now for those four riders ahead. This is absolutely what we expected. Just look at the teammates now of the big sprinters, Pataki and Cavendish in particular, driving the peloton, and all of a sudden it's closing in. 44 seconds of the gap, we're just over 10 miles, 17 kilometres out from the finish.
They are very urgent at the front end of the main field, Phil, charging along there. We start to get right into the very heart of the wine-growing area in this part of Bordeaux. And there are so many big Grand Crus in this area. This is the area of the Grave, a very important red wine. And just looking down at this chateau, this is the Chateau of La Louvrière. It's been listed as a natural historical monument since 1991. The majority of the wine grown in this area is Cabernet Sauvignon, 64%. In fact, 30% is Merlot, 3% is Cabernet Franc.
Oh, what a shame, I'm not thirsty today. As the Tour de France goes past the entrance, that beautiful chateau. We're trying to find the race now. The helicopter's got so excited, he's wandered off. He'll pick up the riders very shortly. The gap is just on 3/4 of a minute now for the riders, and they're running into the last 17 kilometres of the day. In fact, it's come down to 40 seconds, and just look at the... Feel sorry for the guys right at the tail of this big peloton now. They're really hanging on. It's desperate moments. Mark Cavendish is clearly feeling good. They're all his teammates on the left of our picture. The boys in blue, their sprinter is Gerald Cholik, and for the moment, Lamprey have disappeared.
Well, Lamprey have switched off a fraction. They're leaving it up to... Well, this is a little bit of disorganization coming now, but this is because of the urgency of the chase at the front. These guys are really now starting to get on the panic button. As you can see, these two riders from Rimram have opened up a 4 or 5 bike length advantage. But it'll get organized as soon as we get onto the big wide stretch of road at 35 seconds. That corresponds to about 550 meters. And on these big, long straights now, they can start to eye up the breakaway group in front of them. They'll start to see the lights on the cars just behind them. Very shortly, I would expect the race referees to pull out the team cars from the behind the breakaway, leaving only the individual car that looks after everybody. I think I just noticed Bradley Wiggins sitting at the back end of that group. He's obviously trying to conserve as much energy as possible for the individual time trial tomorrow. He wants to go out of this race with a good performance. He struggled through the mountains, but he would love to see if he could give a victory to Team Sky. Well, Milram, HTC Colombia and Lamprey have been doing a lot of pace making at the front, and now you can see this is Konstantin Sistov. Very powerful rider, Belarusian rider, formerly champion of his own country, tapping out a mean pedal.
Right, well, I think we're pretty sure who's going to win, Cavendish, Pataki or Cholik. But what about Tor Hushovd? He's just letting them do all the work at 15 to go.
That's all he has to do. But just check at Konstantin Sistov, Phil. At the moment, sitting at the front end of the main field, he is tickling a production of almost 500 watts, and he's cruising along, and I have to say cruising along, at 36 miles an hour. That's about 55 kilometres an hour.
Well, with Tom Cruise in the following cars today, I think that's a perfect analogy. Just under... This is amazing. Look at the clock. We're on 70 kilometres an hour on a totally flat road here.
Well, 70 kilometers an hour, they are charging along, and it's all these teams of the sprinters, they know that it's almost done and dusted. 15 kilometers to go, 30 seconds, that's 500 meters on the straights. They can see them, the concentration of this team. They, you know, despite the fact, Phil, that we're hearing overnight rumors that Mark Cavendish might have a touch of bronchitis, he would not be whipping the team like this if he didn't think he could win.
And they wouldn't have sent three men back to make sure he came through the Pyrenees yesterday and didn't slip off into the abandon. But look at this, Jerome Pino's having a little dig. This is their throes of desperation now. They know they're nearly there. In fact, just seeing them in the backdrop as our camera makes the full pan right. Jerome Pino trying to break up the breakaway, or at least incite them to keep going.
Well, that was his move to try and get off the front. Daniel Oss now says, well, forget about that. You've hurt me, you guys, all through the afternoon. So now I'm off.
Looks like a bit of Morse code down there. Not too sure what that is, but as we see the riders coming underneath, they are physically going at 70 kilometres an hour, and this is not an easy road now. But look at this, the youngest man in the breakaway, Daniel Oss, in his first Tour de France, is going for gold here as he bounds into Bordeaux.
Just gone through the small town of Villeneuve-d'Ornon, just on the outskirts of Bordeaux, and now they're getting into a slightly undulating part of the course. We might even climb up to a massive altitude of around about 25 metres above sea level.
So Cavendish sits in the peloton behind his team here. As the leader here tries to move clear of the field. He's made the best of that false move, as it's turned out, by Jérôme Pinault, and he's added a second. It takes a very strong man to pull away from the peloton at this stage of the Tour de France.
Well, he knows he's at the front end of the Tour. You know, you get the excitement of the Tour de France in your legs at a stage like this, and the excitement of being at the front. You're in front of television cameras going around the world. This is Fabian Wegmann on the front, former German national champion. He's dishing it out as well to Maxime Montfort in second place. He's thinking about Colek. The man behind him, Montfort, is thinking about Mark Cavendish.
I must say, the green jersey of Tor Hushovd, there's still a little ground to make up, but he's quite content to see other riders make the running here, the Norwegian. He's only 4 points to the good over Pataki in that green jersey. Cavendish sits in third place. He really needs to make the most of the stage wins if he's going to force his way into that green jersey competition. It's the second most important jersey in the Tour de France. Introduced back in 1953, ostensibly for the sprinters. That's their yellow jersey in effect. And here comes the catch. The sprinters are going to have their day again.
Well, these three are caught. Let's not forget there's still one man off the front, and that, of course, is Daniel Oss. But he's only leading, Phil, by around about 30 seconds. You can see him just up the road, and I think one man on his own is not going to survive off the front end of a raging peloton, because the raging peloton here this afternoon wants to come into Bordeaux. There's Chris Horner moving up on the right-hand side in the red jersey. Again, he has to stay near the front of the pack, not to go for the sprint at all, but just to make sure there's no split on the run in towards the finish.
And thereby maintaining the 10th place he moved into yesterday. Ryder Hejedar will also be up there. He moved into 8th place yesterday. The two North Americans having a great journey through the Pyrenees. Here's the current leader in his first Tour de France, Daniel Oss, the Italian, riding now on the Leaky Gas team. And they speak of him with glowing terms for the future. Today he's learning just simply the art of pain.
Well, this is all really part of the apprenticeship, part of the learning curve, to know just exactly what the Tour de France is all about, where you have to make the efforts, how you make the efforts. You don't waste an effort in the Tour. And this man at the moment, he knows he's done well to get himself to the final 3 days of racing, and now he's just thinking and dreaming about outwitting the sprinters. However, unfortunately for him, there isn't a tricky run into the finish. There's no left and right to hide away from the main field. This is a long boulevard entrance into Bordeaux.
And this is the Tour de France, and you can see by the thousands of people who have watched this race around, it's 3,600 kilometres. The crowds are enormous, or if not bigger than ever, as the race now comes up the west coast here of France. The weekend will be spent with the time trial in this region, and Sunday they will race to Paris.
Yes, but for the moment, the sprinters have got something in the back of their minds. There's a little bit of organisation just over on the left there, Phil. That, of course, is the riders from Rabobank. They're looking after Denny Menchoff, and they're looking after Robert Hessink. Also at the front, you can see Team Saxo Bank. They're looking after the man in the white jersey, and that, of course, is Andy Schleck. They're all concerned that if there's a crash on the run into the finish, outside of the 3 kilometres to go, and there's a split, they could lose silly time, and it would be silly time to lose 10 seconds at a time like this.
Well, when the first two in the Tour de France are only split by 8, so that could be a reversal in the yellow jersey competition. You saw them all bunny hopping over that little roundabout back there. Has still got control here. There he is, the lonely figure, player trying to plough a trail to Bordeaux as the camera pulls back from our helicopter. Here's the peloton. Little bit of common sense, perhaps. They've slowed down in that pack. 31 seconds now for Daniel Oss, and he's sticking to his guns. And we're going to see 10 kilometres to go, 6 miles to the finish.
Well, he's doing a phenomenal performance. You know, he's never really, I don't think he's won a race in his professional career. He's been a professional for 2 years, turned professional for Liquid Gas. He got a couple of second places on the Tour of Missouri last year. His best performance this year was third on a stage of the Tour of Switzerland, fourth on a stage of the 3 days of La Panne. He's hoping to go better than all of those to try and create the surprise. But when you see the strength of the teams on the front end of the main field, you've got to be a world champion in the individual pursuit, Phil, to try and stay off the front inside the last 10 kilometres.
Oh, very sadly, the Tour of Missouri is no longer, and that was developing into being a very good bike race, but the rumours are very high that there might be a Tour of Colorado next year. So one place loss is another place is gained by the sound of it. 31 seconds now is the gap. We're looking for the 10-kilometre banner. I think they've just gone under it. Did I miss it?
Yes, you did. Oh, just
did
for
I
a own. Fraction.
Never
there,
look
you can
away
see
when you're watching television.
That's never it. Look away because you never know what will happen. You can see a white jersey and a yellow jersey locked together there in about 20th place. Alberto Contador and Andy Schleck locked together as they were yesterday on the slopes of the Tourmalet. This man here is doing a phenomenal ride, but he's still holding on to a 30-second advantage. I am sure that he's pushed the pain barrier just that little bit further here this afternoon in the hope of getting himself a victory.
Well, this is when you don't like to see the rider caught. Of course you don't. David Miller went through all this on stage six into Barcelona last year. He was caught on a little climb, a kilometre from the line when it looked like he was going to win. Daniel Oss might suffer the same fate, but this will be on flat roads now as he races down towards the finish.
Julian Dean riding at the front end of the main field, riding this afternoon for his own account for Team Garmin Transitions and, of course, for New Zealand. And the Kiwi will be looking to see whether or not he can produce those kind of sprints for the finishing line rather than the 200-metre-to-go line that he normally has.
His radio wires dangling there from his the front of his racing jersey. No doubt he's receiving messages from the team manager telling him to go, 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 go. But I'm afraid when you pull back like this, they're 4 seconds closer now, and they can see him at the end of the gun sight. There's still a gap. It's still a chance of a confusion. The peloton's here riding because of the splits in the highway, both sides of the road, and that, strange enough, will help the escape because they can't organise themselves as they might like to.
Yeah, but, Phil, this man's legs are absolutely burning now. They're screaming out to him to say, please stop this. This is not normal. We should not be riding along at 55 kilometres an hour. I need a bit of respite. I need a break. But his mind is telling his body to keep going because this is the Tour de France, and he wants to try and create the surprise. The sprinters, I feel now, are still waiting for the moment to pounce.
The sprinters have got themselves a bit of help from Spain here because the orange jerseys are Samuel Sanchez, the rider who crashed yesterday and hurt his sternum, and he's recovered and he's fighting tomorrow to finish third in the Tour de France. But they've moved up, and that's the keeper Sanchez, nice and safe, and there he is there. So they brought him up, and this is going to confuse the sprinters too. They won't be too happy now with non-sprinters putting riders up here.
Not anymore, because they've put Tony Martin to the front end of this line, and all of a sudden he's really taken this up. A little word there going from Michael Rogers to the rider from Milram saying, hey, keep out of our line. This is our line. We're having the right-hand side of the road here, HTC Columbia. We're looking after our mate Mark Cavendish. Look alongside that line of the HTC Columbia riders, though, because there is the Lamprey lead-out train for Alessandro Pataki. In front of Pataki is Danilo Hondo.
On the right, you've got HTC Columbia, a perfect line of riders. At the back of those white jerseys, as they appear from the camera, is Mark Cavendish. At the back on the left now, Lamprey are in the middle. They're leading Alessandro Pataki. This man is spoiling the party, and long may it succeed. 17 in seconds and 7 kilometres to go.
250 metres, that's all this man is in front of the front end of the main field. They can see him, they can almost touch him. I'm amazed that he's still finding that little bit more power in his legs to keep himself off the front end of this charging main field. It's a second less now, 16 seconds, as this man, Daniel Oss, is hoping to survive, hoping to create what is going to be a very strange and important finish.
Just 16 seconds off the pace, 6.7 kilometres. They're fanning out across the road. Even Alberto Contador's boys in blue are coming to the front now to try and keep him out. Remember, 8 seconds is a blink of the eyelid if there's an accident, and they don't get the same time until they're inside that last 3 kilometres to go. These are desperate moments for the ride. Contador moves up on the left in his yellow jersey.
Tor Hushoff there in the green going around that corner. He's still a long way down as far as I'm concerned, and around about 6 kilometres to go. We're starting to look at a bit of confusion finally. Team Lamprey now are trying to take the reins at the front end of the main field, and we've still got one rider surviving. Daniel Oss is off the front end of the main field. He's hovering at around about the 13-second advantage, but the sprinters now need to take control.
But one thing's for sure now, this 23-year-old first-timer in the Tour de France does have a future in professional bike riding. To hold the riders off in the last 20 kilometres like this is exceptional, but they're breathing down his neck and there's concern on their faces here. They're inside six to go. He's spoiling the organisation now of the sprinters.
This is Ralph Grabs on the front of the yellow of the main group now, trying to keep it organised. I do not know where this young man is getting his power from here this afternoon. His advantage is still the 12 seconds. 12 seconds now is down to 200 metres. Alessandro Petacchi is at the back end of that line of riders in the purple and pink jerseys. He knows what he has to do. He likes the big, long sprint. And it looks now as if it over to the left, Cervelo test team have got themselves organised, because what they're trying to do is now look after the end for their man, Tor Hushov. Team Sky are getting involved. There's Bradley Wiggins.
Mauro Didolto has now got to the front. He's the big, strong man on Lamprey. Sky believe they can finish this off with Eddie Boysenhagen. They've moved him into position on the left of the road. Cavendish is going to feel a little bit claustrophobic now, because the peloton is pushing him over to the trees on the left as we look. 5 kilometres to go. Boy, everybody's going to start to want this guy, Oss, to win this stage right now.
Well, they will. It's 11 seconds, and once he comes to 5 kilometres to go, he's got 1 kilometre, then he's going to take a left-hand turn onto the side of the River Garonne, and then it's a long lineup for the sprint. This is where you don't want to be. It is so hard to sit at the back end of the main field inside of 5 kilometres to go. This is going to take them around about 7.5 minutes, and still there's no real control at the front end of the main field. That's Tony Martin for HTC Colombia. Behind him, Mickey Rogers. Mick Rogers looking for some redemption out of this tour, trying to make sure that they can get another victory there for their man Mark Cavendish, who is still at the back of the line of his riders.
Well, as we watch the riders go now, it is an amazing situation. This one man is somehow holding off the sprinters. This is Bordeaux. This is the capital of the sprinters of the Tour de France. They've finished here 80 times since 1903, and they've got a problem. They can't nail him back.
Well, into fifth position there is Mark Cavendish. He's a long way down in the overall standings, but Oss, I think he's done, Phil. He's just about over. He's just about got to the left-hand bend. He'll come up alongside the Garonne, and all of a sudden, he'll be back in the pack with everybody else, and the sprinters have got exactly what they wanted on this day, but there is not one team yet in full control, and it's Cervelo test team of Tor Hushov who are now starting to come up to the front.
They will turn into the headwind, and I'm afraid to say that will crack poor Daniel Oss. He can't hang on into this wind. It is blowing very, very strongly, and it's swinging from the west to right on his nose as he now goes directly west. He's lining up for the finish. He's inside 4 kilometres to go. As they get inside that 4 kilometres, they're all now looking for who's going to take up the running, and Bradley Wiggins is trying to put Boysenhagen into the sprint. Now, that is not a loss of picture on the top half of the screen. That is actually the Garonne, as we're now on the side and direct approach to the finish.
Tony Martin, he is an unbelievable time trialist at Real Ram, trying to create a bit of a surprise there. I'll tell you one thing, you put your head into the wind like that, it's going to smack you in the face like a hammer. Over on the left, they will not panic at all. The riders from HTC Colombia will get themselves as organised as possible. That looks to me like Linus Gerdeman, the way he's nodding his head there, but you know what, he got 2 metres 50 off the front end of the main field. Not a problem at all for HTC Colombia, they're still in control. Look at the work that's being done here by Tony Martin, and still they're all queuing up behind.
So look at the work that's being done by Bradley Wiggins to try and get Boysenhagen into the race here now, as they continue to drive on and on. Christian Canese takes up the running as well. The peloton can't get any faster, and the road is perfect for a sprint. The speed now is over 70 kilometres an hour.
They've got to keep it high, they've got to keep it stretched out into a long line, because if you start to slow down, all of a sudden it becomes very precarious. Riders come up the back who are not supposed to be involved in sprinting, and that's when accidents happen. This could be the big surprise for Team Sky here this afternoon. They're trying to get their young man, Eddie Boysenhagen, up to the front to get himself a sprint. That could be the respite that HTC Colombia needs to get their man, Mark Cavendish, up to the front.
Well, I can't believe this. At 2.5 kilometres to go, there's been an eclipse. The riders are all dressed in black at the front. This is the closest they've been to getting their man to the line since the race started. They've got it organised now. There's the main train, the Triumph Grand Vitesse. Express heading towards Paris. This is the Express going towards Bordeaux as they pass under the tunnel now. All of Team Sky have got themselves organised. Is this the day?
Well, that's what they've got to do. You've got to take control for the next 2 kilometres. Keep at the front end of the main field. This is Michael Barry. They've got a good organisation, a big lead out. But Bosun Hagen is actually caught in the middle there. He's not right on the tailwind of all of his team helpers. Up there as well, we could see Bradley Wiggins trying to do as much as he could.
2 kilometres less than to go now. Team Sky have got themselves organised. Somebody's even on the radio back there. I think it's Brad Wiggins. As now, what has happened to Cavendish and his HTC boys? They've backed off. This is Wiggins in second place. Slightly longer hair is the youngster. That's Fletcher behind, but Bosun Hagen is the man to drive.
Lovquist is the man on the front, the big, strong rider who's trying to keep this line as good as possible. They've taken control today. They've had a quiet Tour de France ever since the very start. Now they're starting to peel off one by one. Lovquist has done his job. That's the important thing for him. Slipping back now, he's leaving up to the sprinters. Cavendish is still there, filling around about eighth or ninth position.
Well, this has done absolute justice to the sprint town of the Tour de France under that flag, and you see the way it's flying. It's direct ahead wind onto the nose of the riders. The judging of the sprint now has to be to absolute perfection, and Team Sky have got themselves into the drive, but now they're trying to move up also. Julian Dean on Garmin transitions. Bernard Eisel is the first to mark Cavendish's team, but you know, they're compromised here.
Working up there into fourth position, the orange jersey is Oscar Freire. There's a big organisation. Cavendish is trying to find his way through. Hushoft has moved up over on the right-hand side there. Cavendish is going to do this all on his own. Pataki's right through in the middle. Hushoft has got the lead out he needs, but Cavendish is up into sixth position.
Cavendish is locked onto the green jersey's wheel here. Now they're waiting to see Hushoft go, but also they're looking a little bit concerned. In the pink is up Pataki. Pataki is anxious to move up alongside Cavendish now. As the move comes on the far right, the going to have to let Hushoff go, otherwise it'll all be over. And Pataki is trying to fight for the middle. Pataki goes, Hushoff goes. Remember the headwind. The Norwegian flags fly here, but Cavendish, forget it. The man has just gone again. The man with three legs from the Isle of Man just said, boys, what's all the problem? And he gets his 14th stage win in the Tour de France. I think it's Dean has got second and possibly Pataki third or fourth. Paul, he makes it look just a little bit too easy.
You cannot control that man when he feels the victory at the end of his fingertips. He really wants to get it. That was a confusing sprint. That wasn't a real straight sprint. They were all over the road, left and right, waiting for the door to open. He kept his calm and he leapt out of the pack and bang, he got it. Good win there for this man, Mark Cavendish. This is the fourth win of the Tour this year, 14th of his career.
Well, he rides that Black Scott Addict bike, and he's taken 4 wins on it now. That is incredible. Mark Cavendish, well, ill, sick, bronchitis or what, when you see that finishing line. But this time was a brilliant race to line and the most difficult one to judge. I thought that Tor Hushoft had read it perfectly here, and it was Cavendish that was set to come off his wheel. Pataki tried to go first, but once the final kick came, I think when Mark saw Cavendish go, he chased him, but he's just too quick for him.
Well, this was the ideal move. He didn't want to go early. He knew that the wind was coming right into the riders' faces. He used Alessandro Pataki, used his slipstream for a fraction, and then leaped by him. But look at the gap. He's opening the gap all the way to the line.
It's a long way.
I think this is the easiest victory, Phil, that he's actually got in the Tour so far.
It is such a long. I think Julian Dean will have pipped Pataki there for second place. But what an incredible sprint that was.
Well, here's confirmation then, Cavendish getting ahead of Julian Dean, Alessandro Pataki and Robbie McEwen. McEwen again getting a fourth position there. Ferreira was in the mix and got across the line in fifth. Eddie Bosun Hagen got himself sixth. Rolands Rojas, and rounding out the top ten, there's a bit of a surprise. Ruben Perez, he's actually one of the climbers and he obviously got involved in that sprint. How about that for a backdrop? That is where the race has just finished here this afternoon, and Mark Cavendish from Great Britain got himself another victory under his belt with a phenomenal time sprint to the line there. He really did want that. The team did a great job in doing all of the pacemaking in the early part of the stage, timed it to perfection, caught poor old Daniel Oss at 4 kilometres to go to the line, then all of a sudden they wiped him away. They didn't take any prisoners at all, did they, this afternoon as they came up to the finish line. And what a great sprint that was. Team Sky tried. They tried to get themselves organised. But there's not a lot you can do, I think, in these day, this day and age against Mark Cavendish, because his team, they are dedicated to doing all of the work and all of the pacemaking, and he came up to the line and finished it off. And theoretically, there shouldn't be any change in the overall standings because nearly everybody finished there in the main field. So Contador and Schleck are still locked together by that 8 seconds. Sammy Sanchez is in third at 3:32, and Denny Menchov is in fourth at 3:53.